So yesterday's session, I think, was a very important one, and a very one full of a lot of ideas, information, knowledge, and I was very pleased with the success of yesterday's session. Today promises to be equally successful because of the people who have agreed to share their perspectives with us, and we will hear from each of them as printed on the program, and following their presentations, we'll have a brief time for questions and answers. But then, after all of the speakers have presented, they will assemble here on the stage for a panel, and we'll have further discussion from the audience on their various presentations. Our first speaker this morning is Dr. M. Roy Wilson, president of Wayne State University, and Roy, as all of you know, is an ophthalmologist. I've known Dr. Wilson for a number of years when he was dean at Drew School of Medicine. Then, as I recall, went to Creighton and served there as dean, then to the University of Texas Medical Center in Amarillo as vice president for health affairs. And he kept his momentum and went on then to the University of Colorado in Denver as president of that institution. When he completed his tenure there, he joined the leadership at the National Institutes of Health as the deputy director of the National the National Center for Research in Minority Health and Health Disparities. So, and then I believe about a year ago, came to Wayne State as the new president of that very important institution. So in Dr. Wilson, we have a very seasoned, successful academic leader and administrator, and I'm very pleased that he will share with us his talk, The Role of Urban-Serving Universities in Improving the Health of Their Communities. Dr. Wilson.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sullivan. Can I have my slides, or should I click? Go ahead. Okay. You know, about 3 years ago now, when I was at the NIH, after long history of, as Dr. Sullivan mentioned, being in academic institutions my entire career, there were a lot of things I really loved about the NIH, but I was beginning to miss being in a university setting, the cadence of university life and the day-to-day decision making of universities. And I was having dinner with a friend of mine, and I was talking about some of these things, and she said, you know, would you ever go back to being a university president? And I said, you know, I don't know, but if I do, there would be very specific criteria that that university would have to have, because I've been at rural universities, urban universities, private universities, public universities. And she said, well, what are these criteria? So I said, it would have to be a public university, it would have to be an urban university, it would have to be a university that does a lot of research, and because I'm a physician, I thought it would be value added to have a medical school. But all of these things, plus they had to be intimately connected to the community. And I'm going to get back to that later. But this is a picture of a daruma doll. And in Japanese custom, you paint one eye at a time when you set a goal or you make a wish, a desire of some sort. And then you paint the other eye when that goal or desire is fulfilled. So let me just go ahead and talk a little bit about the role that public urban research universities have in terms of impacting its communities, and it's immense. You can see here on this slide that, first of all, the number of students that are trained, the expenditures, the economic development that happens as a result of these universities, and the latest data I was able to get was 2012-13. And so I did the corresponding data for Wayne State University. All these numbers are much higher for Wayne State, except for maybe faculty and staff. But the rest of the numbers are higher. But you can see that these universities do have a tremendous impact monetarily on its communities. Now, another way of looking at the impact of these universities is to look at the Carnegie Classification for Community Engagement. And a lot of people know about the Carnegie Classification for Research, but they also have one for community engagement. And 28.6% of public urban research universities have that highest designation. 12.9% or 6% of research universities and 6.5% of all universities have gotten that highest designation for community engagement. Now, these urban research universities or urban universities in general are having a tremendous impact, and they're continuing to have even more. And part of the reason is because cities themselves are becoming more important. You know, there was a time particularly during the time of the land-grant universities when they were first coming on board, that it was an agrarian economy, and the demographics have really shifted since that time. And so more people now, by far, live in cities, more people moving into urban cores than moving out of urban cores. The 10 top metropolitan areas make up just 12% of the land mass, but produce 75% of the gross domestic product. And you can see also generate 78% of competitive patents and account for 68% of the nation's job. In today's real major societal problems, whether it's in transportation, whether it's in housing, sustainability, and certainly health, tend to be in urban cores. And so urban research universities are uniquely positioned to engage in these urban challenges. Now, there's a coalition of urban serving universities that are made up of about, probably around 60 universities now that are in the 100 most populous metropolitan areas. Now, they're not all research universities. You can see the makeup of them. Some of them actually are freestanding medical schools and medical centers, and they have a tremendous impact, particularly on the health aspects of communities. But you can see the makeup, that many of them are doctoral universities without medical centers. Some of them are more regional universities. The main part of it, though, are research universities with high research or very high research activity. But whatever the makeup of the university, when a survey was done, and I got involved with this coalition of urban serving universities when I was chancellor of University of Colorado, is that you can see from this slide that the preponderance of universities, regardless of the type of university, are involved in some way by impacting their communities, whether it's involved in PK, whether it's involved in community partnerships, partnerships with the state, and in this case also you can see public health partnerships. But almost 100% are involved with PK through 16 school initiatives and partnerships, some sort of partnerships with local government, and the rest as you can see here. Now, focusing a bit now on just the health aspects of things as I'm charged to do, I think there are a number of ways, and I'm only going to pick four. There are a number of ways in which urban serving universities can impact the health of their communities. Public health partnerships, as was just mentioned, is one, but also translational research, student engagement with the community, and health workforce diversity. I'm going to talk about each of these briefly. Let me start with translational research, and I think all of you know that translational research is basically basic research that is then goes on, the knowledge is then used to directly impact the health of communities in a positive way, whereas basic research is usually knowledge for the sake of knowledge. And, you know, in recent years, there's been some sort of tension between the translational research and the basic research world. You know, in my view, I think that they're both very important. I'm a very strong supporter of basic research. I think many of the major discoveries that have been made that have had tremendous impact later on had been knowledge that was gained just for the sake of knowledge that turned out to have relevance later on. But having said that, I think that urban research universities have an obligatory role in performing research that directly impacts its communities. Now, certainly at the NIH, there's been a bit of a shift over the past decade or so toward shifting more monies toward translational research, and I think maybe that's where some of the tension comes in between basic science and translational. Some of that shift has come in through the development of the Clinical Translational Science Awards, but the fact of the matter is that this is in response to what Congress is mandating. Congress is saying we want more research that directly impacts the population. As can be seen just very recently, just within the this past month, of having bipartisan support in passing, at least through the House, the 21st Century Cures Act that's going to put almost $9 billion into the NIH over the next 4 or 5 years toward the innovation fund to try to get treatments out into the population faster. Let me shift gears and talk about the public health partnerships, and I'll use an example from Wayne State. Wayne State has the, in partnership with DMC, has the only NIH research center outside of Bethesda. It's called the Perinatology Research Branch. And part of that reason is because some of the health disparities that Mallett talked about in terms of Detroit. I mean, we are a city that has a very challenged population from a health perspective. So in 2002, we were able to get a 10-year, $167 million grant that was housed here at Wayne State and DMC. It was competitively rebid in 2013 with a very, very strong competition from Yale and a bunch of other places. But again, we were able to win out predominantly, I think, because of the population here in Detroit. And Roberto Romero and Sonia Hassan are the leaders of this, of the PRB. Now, one of the things that they found out, and I wonder if this has a pointer. Well, if not, I think you can see it. There's a, this is an ultrasound picture. And you see that this person has a short cervix. And one of the things that they found out is if you have a short cervix, that the chances of spontaneous preterm birth is about 50%. But another piece of research shows that if you use vaginal progesterone in these patients with short cervix as seen by ultrasound, you can greatly reduce preterm birth. And that's important, of course, because preterm birth leads to infant mortality, infant morbidity, and costs the United States a whole lot of money. Here in Detroit, it's particularly important because the overall rate of preterm birth is much higher in Detroit than in the national population by a huge amount. In fact, it's higher than in many third world countries. So as a result of this, the mayor of Detroit, Mayor Duggan, decided to do something about it and put together a coalition. He asked that Sonia Hassan is, again, is there a pointer here? Or do you have one? that Sonia Hassan to lead this effort, and I'm sorry I can't point to the people here, but it's a partnership between Wayne State University, Henry Ford is represented, so is the DMC, St. John's Hospital, also insurance company in terms of the Meridian Health Plans. Yale is part of it in the city of Detroit. And what this is a partnership to get people who are pregnant, women who are pregnant, to be able to come in for an ultrasound, and if they have short cervix, to be treated. And there are a number of other things going on. I can't really see my slides here, so I'm going to have to just have you read this, but the educational aspects of it, making sure that there's breastfeeding education, some of the barriers that these patients have in terms of transportation and insurance is taken care of, and tremendous amount of media coverage. And as a result, and you can see some of the media coverage here. But this is an example of how a partnership between major insurers, major healthcare providers in a university can really improve the health of a community in a very tangible way. And this is also quite, coincidentally, is a great example of translational research. Now, let me move forward with student engagement for a second. And, you know, certainly, I think all of you, you know that whenever there's a medical center, there's students that do a lot. You know, they have student-run clinics and all that. But there's other ways that students are engaged that can, particularly in a comprehensive university, that can really impact the community in a positive way in a, from a health perspective that doesn't even have anything to do with the medical school or nursing school or any of the health profession schools. And so I took an example from Wayne State that's actually from the law school, and this video was made for another purpose, but I think it still has the, a point that's to be made.
I was inspired to start legal advocacy for people with cancer because I have worked my entire life with cancer patients. I'm an oncology social worker of over 21 years experience, and I went and got my law degree, and I knew somehow I wanted to combine my passion for working with cancer patients, helping them solve their problems and easing their stress, with my legal skills. There's this new burgeoning movement called medical legal partnerships, and it's where legal help becomes integrated right into healthcare delivery. Cancer patients, especially when they're going through treatment, just experience a huge range of stressors, and many of them have legal solutions. Insurance, housing, employment, life planning, and public benefits. So we help clients in all those five areas of law. If there's one thing that cancer patients will say over and over again is they just feel out of control, So we can provide such a service for helping them regain that control. The students can take a really leadership role in really assisting the clients. There are hundreds of pivotal moments I've had throughout this entire experience, from a student running into my office waving a piece of paper saying, Kathy, we just got the decision, the Social Security agreed with us, we're gonna be able to get our clients' benefits, to ultimately the clients themselves. I can't even tell you the clients that just stop, look you in the eyes and just say, thanks, you have no idea, none, you and your students have no idea about what your work did to improve my life. Those are lessons they're never gonna forget. They're never gonna forget the resiliency of the human spirit. And it really makes them contemplate what kind of attorney they're gonna be, but more important, what kind of human being they're gonna be.
So again, this is an example from our law school. So in a comprehensive university, I think there are a lot of ways that the health of the community can be impacted through student engagement. The last thing I want to talk about, and I want to spend a little bit more time on this one because it's an area that I feel very strongly about, and it's the issue of health workforce diversity. And I know this is an area that many of you also feel very strongly about. But the demographics, I'm not going to read them. But you know, all of you are very familiar with the change in demographics and the fact that we're going to be a minority-majority nation by 2050. And the, one of the things that I'm certainly very bothered by is the fact that, particularly in medical school, that only the rich seem to be able to get a medical education these days, and that the those from you know, less fortunate backgrounds are becoming left out. And so. Again, going back to the Coalition of Urban Serving Universities, the coalition was really interested in three things. One was the educational pipeline. The second was the strengthening communities. And then the third initiative was the Urban Health Initiative. And I had the privilege of being the inaugural chair of the Urban Health Initiative. And we decided that we were going to focus on strengthening the urban health workforce, because that's an area that we felt that all of the members of the coalition could participate in. You don't have to have a medical school. You know, most of these universities at least had a nursing school or had a health science school of some sort, whether it was physical therapy or occupational therapy or something where they can contribute to the urban health workforce and from a health perspective. And one of the first things that we did was to partner with the AAMC and the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities and got an NIH grant through NIMHD to form the Urban Universities for Health, or UU Health, as it's called. Concentrate on three things: the urban education pipeline partnerships, the cultural competency of institutions, and then, as I mentioned, the health professions recruitment and admission practice. And we did something, a very specific activity related to the latter. There was a national survey that we conducted of holistic admissions. Again, I'm sorry, I don't have a pointer here, but the person in the red vest is the, oh, thank you so much. You are prepared. So this person in the red vest is the PI. Mark Neve right here is the PI of the entire UU Health. Greer Gleiser is the PI of this study. This is Yvonne Maddox from NIMHD, and as I mentioned, we got funding from NIMHD. Daryl Kirch from AAMC, the CEO, and Neil Theobald, the president of Temple, because they did something very interesting right before this press conference, which was they decided to not require ACT and SAT examinations, but really go into a holistic review. And so this was a study of a national study of holistic review and getting into health professional schools. Now, most times when you talk about holistic review, and not everybody does it, the main barrier in acceptance by faculty in adopting holistic review is that they think it's going to in some way decrease their outcomes, that the students won't do as well and therefore the school won't rank as high and things like that. But when you look at it, and this is a very telling slide, you can see that for graduation rates in those places that practice holistic review, that it was either unchanged or increased. The results are actually better while the diversity increased. And then here, for the average GPA of the class, again, either unchanged or improved. And then finally, the average number of attempts on the board exams, either unchanged or improved. So this argument that somehow by practicing holistic review and not relying solely on standardized test scores and other objective measures is somehow going to lead to worse outcomes just does not hold water when you look at it from a research perspective. And there's other research that's been done before, but this was a national study. And I'm embarrassed to say that even at my own university, at our medical school, we did not practice holistic review, but we're gonna continue to make progress and change some of these things and get beyond the barriers that people put up by using data to show that it really does not decrease the outcomes, but in fact, if anything, diversity is increased and it's going to. Thank you. So let me just conclude by talking about, you know, why I think we do not have a sufficiently diverse workforce. You know, what's happened? And there are a lot of reasons that one can speculate. And these that I have up here are not the most important reasons necessarily. You know, there are pipeline issues and things like that. But I just want to discuss these four. The first one is the challenges on affirmative action over the past couple of decades. But it's not just that. It's really the institutional responses to the challenges. You know, I've been at different universities in leadership roles, as was mentioned already. And it's remarkable what the general counsel, what the influence the general counsel can have on the president and on the institution in terms of how you respond to the affirmative action rulings that have come about. Too often, institutions use the affirmative action rulings as an excuse not to do anything. And they use the legal argument, well, we can't do this because of this, or we can't do this because of that. Whereas other institutions somehow find a way to deal with it, be legal, work within the laws, but do what has to be done. And so it's not just the fact that the Supreme Court has made certain rulings, it's how the institutions respond to those rulings. And in our own case, I would tell you that we have something called Prop 2 in the state of Michigan that has restricted our use of affirmative action, and that was the excuse used at Wayne State. But Michigan and Michigan State has continued to have a diverse medical school class coming in. So it's really the institutional response that's really more important. And then the second, and these are very insidious, and that's why I'm talking about them, is the over-reliance on standardized test scores. You know, I'd rather that MCATs be pass-fail. You know, there's really no difference between in the outcomes between a person who scores a 26 or 30. But I can tell you that medical schools look very carefully at these things because it helps or it influences their national rankings. And it's not just admin to medical school. It goes all along the line to residencies, to specialties as opposed to family medicine. You know, I know we are all supposed to be pushing primary care, but I'm a specialist and I care about specialists too. And I can tell you that it is so difficult now to get a residency in dermatology and ophthalmology and all these kinds of specialties because you have to score in the 95th percentile on these things. I don't know what I scored. I don't think I scored in the 95th percentile when I was going to school. So, you know, it's this insidious thing that's going on. And so I think that there's a critical role of urban serving universities to try to address some of this by looking at these issues, not getting caught up in this rankings games, and doing what's right to make sure that science best practices are followed to be able to have a diverse workforce. And then finally, this is my concluding slide. You know, I didn't finish the story that I started off with in terms of my conversation over dinner. And so, you know, after I went through all of this about, you know, being public and urban and research, connected to the community, my friend asked me, he said, well, you know, what university would match all those criteria? And I really didn't have one in mind at the time. I was just listening to criteria. And so I thought for a minute, and I said, you know, Wayne State does. And so 3 or 4 months later, I got a call from Wayne State, and they wanted to know if I'd be interested in being a candidate, and here I am. And so I've colored in the other eye. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Wilson, for a great presentation. We have time for one or two questions, and let me begin. How many universities are there in the urban serving group and then public versus private?
Right. So they're all public. Okay. And there's about 60 now in that group. Now, at the time that the survey was done, it was 48, but I think some more universities have joined that group now.
Very good. Thank you. Questions?
First of all, thank you, Dr. Wilson, for...
Excuse me. Could you please give your name and organization and your question?
I'm Woody Myers. I'm the CEO of a company called Horizon Health and an NMA member. I just want to thank Dr. Wilson for his outstanding presentation of all the things he's done. I would apply to be the president of his fan club, but the line is too long for people. I would like to ask you a question, Roy, that I tried to get Dr. Williscroft to comment on yesterday, and maybe you have a way to go approach this. I'm reading information regarding the shortage of healthcare providers, physicians specifically in the state of Michigan. And I'm told by this article that there's going to be like a shortage of 4,000 physicians in 2020 in Michigan. And the response has been in Michigan to create three new medical schools. I don't know if they're allopathic or osteopathic. The Oakland University of Beaumont, the CMU College of Medicine, the WMU School, they're going to produce, according to this, a couple hundred graduates. Yet your university and the University of Michigan, who have been doing this forever, who understand how to create medical students and turn them into physicians, are not able, are not willing, or can't, or for whatever reason, aren't expanding to fill that gap and void. And as I think as many people in this audience know, in the United States today, about 25% of the physicians who are licensed to practice in our country graduated in foreign medical schools. So the market is there. Yet American medical schools are not filling the demand. And as the demand increases, new institutions are coming up, which I do not believe will have anywhere close to the quality of physician that you will produce or that other schools that have been here for a while will produce. And the growth industry in our if I had to invest, it would be in Caribbean medical schools, because they are just springing up like crazy to fill this gap, unfortunately. So help me understand the economics that keep you from doubling or tripling your class size and filling this void.
So for those of you who don't know, Dr. Williscroft is the dean at University of Michigan. And if he didn't answer that question, it's probably because he's politically astute. But so I give you my view, though. I think that we have an education issue in Michigan in the sense that the Michigan universities have tremendous constitutional authority. There is no system of higher education here, or coordinating body for higher education. So any university in Michigan can do whatever they want to do, basically. They're governed by their board of, in particular, the big three, the University of Michigan, Michigan State, and Wayne State. It's really the Board of Regents that can basically do what they want. And so there is no coordinating body, but there's a tremendous amount of autonomy in throughout the 15 universities. And so I think you're right that you know, there have been other medical schools that have sprung up because there just isn't any control over it. And I agree with you that it probably is not well thought out to just, you know, have other medical schools come up like this. You know, part of the problem, though, is that a lot of universities think that it's prestigious to have a medical school, or that there'll be more funding because of medical schools. The reality is that medical schools cost money, and it costs a lot of money. And so just by bringing on a medical school doesn't necessarily mean that the university will have, you know, a bigger budget, more money, and all that. It costs a lot of money to do these. We have the largest single campus medical school in the nation. Okay, we take 300 students a year. We would not be able to probably take any much more than that. Okay, that's the reality of it. However, having said that, I think that we've been very successful, as well as University of Michigan and Michigan State, in providing what Michigan needs over the years. If there's going to be a shortage of 4,000 or so, there probably is some room for a little bit more growth from other medical schools. My only issue is I think it should be in a controlled fashion with some sort of controlling coordinating body that's making sure that it's being done in a logical and rational way.
My name is George Hill from Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. Roy, I really enjoyed your presentation. I have two really related questions. The first deals with the issue that you raised of trying to convince members of an admissions committee or higher up individuals in the medical school, deans, et cetera, that a holistic review is important and critical when they are focusing on rankings, whether they're in the top 10 or top 20 or top whatever. With your experience in academia, how do you deal with that issue if you're trying to be more diverse and inclusive and you're working in that area, when in fact the individuals who you report to or the individuals on the committee are kind of ensconced in that philosophy? And the second is a point that Valerie raised yesterday, and that is, how do you deal with organizations like the AMA, it was in that situation, when they come out with initiatives and they're not inclusive, but they say they want to be innovative. How do you communicate with them in a way, or how do you get them to understand that, you know, diversity and inclusion and innovation all go together, instead of we're going to pick people or we're going to have kind of a group of individuals that kind of look like us, et cetera? I mean, it's 2015. Why is that still occurring? Why are we still doing it? Thanks. And again, I really appreciate it.
Yeah. So on your first point, you know, the best way to rise in your rankings is to have high board scores. And the best way to get high board scores is by admitting people who have had very high MCAT scores. There's a high correlation between high test takers that test well in one kind of test versus another. So if you just concentrate on high test takers for the MCATs, you're likely going to have high test scores for the boards. We, again, I'm airing out some dirty laundry, but we had a policy that in order to make the cutoff to even be interviewed, you had to have an MCAT score of 30 and, not or, and a GPA of 3.75. Do you know an MCAT score of 30 is around the 80th percentile? The average is somewhere around 25. Okay. So just right there, you're going to be lopping off a huge percentage of minorities who are able to do medical school very successfully, but don't even have a chance to get into the door to be interviewed, to look at some other things like motivation and things like that. So to answer your question, and I'm going to be very blunt about it, is how do you change that? Institutional leadership. And if you have to make a change, you have to make a change. And we're overhauling our medical school right now.
Thank you.
Final question.
Okay. I'm Linda Walden. I'm from Georgia, president of Georgia State Medical Association. And I also sit on the admissions committee of Mercer University School of Medicine, where I received my MD degree. My concern and my question to you is, first of all, I was just appalled when I found out that Mercer University has reserve admission seats for three students that attend a private college. I think it's Agnes Scott. And if they maintain a GPA of 3.5, they make 29 or above on their MCAT, and they do consistently well during their 4 years, they will be guaranteed a seat. And I'm like, well, how can this be so? Why isn't this happening at all of the undergraduate, particularly minority, historically black colleges? And so I wanted to know, what can we do to get our historically black colleges, such as Spelman and Albany State University, and others in the state of Georgia to be guaranteed seats as well. I've had to argue with them about the MCAT scores because they were too high, 28, you know, to say, yes, you'll do well. No, I said for minorities, they can do well if it's 24 or 25. And finally, they lowered it when they saw they weren't getting many minorities to apply or get in. So what can we do to get our historically black colleges on the same page so that they can also have students that will be reserved seats if they maintain these GPAs, as well as MCAT scores? Because it should be happening across the board, not just a selected private college because they pay a lot of money to go to school and they know they don't have to worry about loans when they go to medical school.
Yeah. Well, you know, I can't speak to the specific case. I don't know the politics involved with that, but I understand the question in terms of more broadly, you know, what can we do? I think the guaranteed admissions thing, by the way, is actually a very good way of helping to diversify a medical school class. At the University of Colorado, right before I left, we instituted a guaranteed admissions where students were admitted to the general academic campus, to the arts and sciences, and admitted to the medical school at the same time. But we targeted minorities and gave them full scholarships. So it wasn't really minority, it was low income, and it's a proxy for minorities. And within a few years, in fact, we had enough money for 10. We had people, and they were all minorities on the first one. We had people in the waiting list that wanted to get into this program, and and these were all very high achieving minority students who wanted to come because they were guaranteed the spot in the medical school. A lot of them were Hispanic, didn't want to leave their family surroundings, and could have probably gone somewhere else if they had just gone to college first and then applied wherever, but they wanted that guarantee. So we were able to quickly diversify our medical school class at Colorado through that mechanism and some other things too. So I do think it's an effective mechanism for diversifying a medical school class. So the question is, you know, why not do that with historically black schools and medical schools? And I'll leave that up to Valerie Montgomery Rice, who's going to be coming up here next, because you know, she's in Georgia and head of a historically black medical school, and I'm sure that these kinds of partnerships could probably work. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Wilson. I'm sure that during our panel discussion there will be additional comments or questions about urban serving universities and their roles, because we've seen the phenomenon over the past three decades of these institutions mushrooming in our central cities, where they provide not only an educational environment but a strong economic contributors to their cities as well. Our next speaker is the president and dean of Morehouse School of Medicine, Dr. Valerie Montgomery Rice, who has been president for a little bit more than a year. She came to Morehouse from Meharry Medical College and has a distinguished career of leadership. She has hit the ground running at the Morehouse School of Medicine. And among the things that she or the panel might discuss, of course, is a different kind of index that was published in 2011, the Social Mission Index, judging medical schools by the diversity, by the percentage of the graduates going into primary care. This was coming out of George Washington University, Dr. Fitzhugh Mullen. And on that index, Morehouse School of Medicine ranked number one of all the medical schools in the country. And Meharry was number two. And I believe Howard was number three. This created kind of an uproar at the AAMC. And of course, we might discuss that a little later. But indeed, it's my pleasure to bring to you the first female president of Morehouse School of Medicine, Dr. Valerie Montgomery Rice.
Good morning. Thank you, Dr. Sullivan. And again, let me give acknowledgement to Dr. Sanders for putting together, along with Dr. Sullivan, I think such a good day yesterday and today. And to Dr. Wilson, Roy, thank you. Wayne State is one of my alma maters. Thank you for recognizing its place. Dr. Veronica Mallard and I were fellows there. And so we were with Roberto Romero doing all of those cervical scans in order to support that data. And it was great work. And it has made a difference in the lives of so many women. And it was done at Wayne State at an urban serving institution that really has always cared about its community. So thank you for bringing that back to Wayne State. And I know that we're gonna see increased diversity in your class size because you understand that diversity does lead to innovation. I've been tasked with talking about the role of minority health profession school. Having served at two of them, I may have a little bit of experience, even though all of my education and training were at majority institutions and urban serving institutions. And I also added to this the challenges and rewards from diversity of the nation's physicians and the contributions of minority health professions to the health system. I'm gonna talk about it from a perspective of a health equity though, because at Morehouse School of Medicine, we have a new vision statement. It is leading the creation and advancement of health equity because we understand that it's not enough just to continue to document health disparities, that we actually have to have conversations about what's in the gap. And then the gap is the opportunity to actually lead and create health equity. I'm going to talk about the role of the Minority Health Profession School as I was charged, and then I'm going to talk about why this matters. So if you look at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, they will give you this definition of health equity. Having every person having the opportunity to attain his or her full health potential. No one is disadvantaged from achieving this potential because of social position or other socially determined circumstances. But this is how we look at it at Morehouse School of Medicine. Most of us can relate to going to a ball game. You go to the ball game, you pay your $5 to get in, back in the 60s maybe, but you pay your money to get in. And everybody just wants to see the game. Some people come who are short, some are medium height, and some are tall. And there's a fence in front of you. And you can see here on the left-hand side that if I give everybody the same size box to see the game, that little short person could jump up, but they would miss part of the game many parts of the time. The middle person might be able to see it, but he's just over the fence. And the tall person would be able to see it and probably block some people behind him because he was already tall. But what if I actually gave people what they need, when they need it, and the amount they need to achieve their optimal level of health? So the short person would get two boxes, the middle person would get one box, the last person, the tall person, wouldn't get a box at all because they can already see the game. Remember, the objective is to see the ball game. And that's what we have to remember in health equity. We want to give people what they need when they need it and the amount they need to reach their optimal level of health, because all of us come with different circumstances. So let's talk about achieving health equity as it relates to diversity. All of us have read these headlines: racial diversity in medical profession, the impact of affirmative action, the underrepresentation of women in leadership roles, how do we advance the Latino physician workforce, why just filling the pipeline won't diversify the STEM fields, bias, black lives, and academic medicine, all headlines over the last 2 years. And Mark Neve shared with us some of this information yesterday. You can see we really are flatline in our underrepresented minorities. in increasing their applications to medical school. And you can see that depending really on the flow of the economy, in the majority population, you see more or less people applying to medical school. And of course, we see the increase in Asian students. And then, of course, this mirrors what you see matriculating. And here's what I would bring your attention to. When you look here at the U.S. matriculants by race and ethnicity, we continue to have a significant number, even though a slight decrease in whites. But again, we're flatline here in blacks. And when you look at blacks and African Americans in 2014, 1,227 attended medical school. Mark shared with you this gap that we began to see, and this does not parallel what happens in other underrepresented minorities. So if you look at Hispanic data, you will see that you see an increase in both male and female applicants and matriculants. But here in 1985, black women began to surpass black men in attending medical school, and that gap has only widened. Such you all that in 2014, there are only 515 black males who attended medical school. And of that, about 271 checked the box that they were African American. And this is the applicant pool. Now, what about GME? When we look at the 120,000 total residents trained nationally last in 2013-2014, you can see that about 5% of them were black, 5% of them were Hispanic, 0.22 were Native American, 18% were Asian, and about 43% were white. And of course, if you don't have as many black students going to medical school, are being trained as residents, then it's no surprise that the U.S. medical school faculty, only 2.7% are black, and 5.4% are Hispanic or Latino, and 0.1% are Native American. So that should not be a surprise based on what the pipeline looks like. So what is the role of minority health profession school? How do we fare in this? How do we educate and train the next generation? And how does that contribute to health equity? We believe that diversity is the key. We do believe that it leads to innovation. Minority-serving institutions continue to be the largest producers of black or African-American and Hispanic or Latino physicians and biomedical scientists, and I will share the data with you. These are the undergraduate schools where the doctorate recipients from 2002 to 2006, this is where they came from. Howard, Spelman, Florida A&M, Hampton, Morehouse College, North Carolina A&T, Southern University, Xavier, Morgan State, Tuskegee. You have to get down to about to number 11 before you start to get to really one of the majority institutions. Now, the top institutions awarding the doctorates, Howard University is at the top of this. And so that meant that those students from these schools matriculated at a lot of different other institutions. And that's important because they were able to bring their learnings and their cultural competence, hopefully, to these environments that impacted the learning environment. We have a lot of data in the AAMC that really shows us that who you sit next to in the classroom and how you engage with that individual and learn from that individual does impact your ability to provide culturally competent or culturally relevant care to a diverse population. And when you look, percentage of African-American biological science PhDs and HBCUs, it hovers somewhere around 16 to 18%. What about the GME? At the three HBCU medical schools, you can see there are 235 residents at Howard with 16 residency programs. Meharry Medical College has 108 residents with 6 residency programs. Morehouse School of Medicine has 133 residents with 7 residency programs. And when we look at our data, we really do track intentionally how are we doing with African American males, and we can see that that is about 13% of all the residents that we're trained at MSM. So we're training a fair number of women at MSM as compared to men. Now, what is our challenge? Our challenges are significant in the fact that when you look at high school graduation dropout rates, race and ethnicity, you can see the dropout rate among blacks compared to Hispanics compared to whites. And then you can see the baseline, flatline pretty much, of college enrollment. And I put this report up here because I think none of us should lose sight of what's happening in the prison system and how that is impacting the pipeline. And one of the things in this report, it talks about the over 500,000 prisoners who are released every year. And who do they become? First of all, many of them are African American males, and they're released into an environment that does not give them an opportunity to redeem themselves or replenish their opportunity to contribute to the workforce. Everybody loves this slide. We took a lot of time to put this slide together. It's important because it's information that we know and understand how many of the social determinants impact this pipeline of people who would actually be able to attend medical school. And I'm just going to use as a proxy right now, black men. So in 2012, you all, there was approximately 2.3 million young black men ages 18 to 24 living in the United States. And in 2012, there were 24 million households, 35% of the population, that were single parent households. But for African American males, 70% of them in that 18 to 24 age range lived in a single parent household, social determinant. 52% of African American males graduated from high school that year, social determinant. 36% of them enrolled, enrollment rate for college. 66% of them had to receive Pell Grants, social determinant. The national college graduation rate for black males, 33.1%, social determinant. Prison incarceration rate, though, for African American males, 3,074 for every 100,000 residents, as compared to Hispanics, 1,258, and compared to whites, 459, social determinant. 1,320 black male applicants to medical school. However, you all, 2,859 of them took the MCAT. I want that to sit on you. Only 46% of the black males who took the MCAT actually applied to medical school, as compared to whites, 73% of the time when a white male takes the MCAT, he applies to medical school, 35% for Hispanics. We're working with the AAMC to confirm all of this data because this doesn't make any sense to us. Have we really sent this message that the MCAT is that important, that you go through all the milestones, graduate from college, take the MCAT, and you believe your score is so low that you won't even apply to medical school? So it's not a wonder that in 2012, we only had 500 black males in medical school, and 276 of them were African American. So it's no wonder why only 1 in 8 Americans are African American physicians, and 1 in 15 are doctors. Now, where do these students come from, black students come from? Morehouse College, University of Florida, University of Maryland, Xavier, Oakwood, University of Georgia. These are the top ones by men and women who supply black male applicants, top 12 schools. If you were to look at top who supply black male applicants by college, Morehouse College continues to do so, and you can see not many of our other institutions. What's the success rate? If you look at this, you can look applied but not accepted. It's somewhere between 57 to 60%. And then this is looking at from 1980 to 2012, what medical schools graduated 350 or more black or African American physicians? Howard, Meharry, University of Illinois, Wayne State, Morehouse School of Medicine, University of North Carolina School of Medicine, et cetera. So you can see, if it were not for Howard, Meharry, and Wayne State is going to be back in there. We know that. I can feel it. Many of us know that we would not be sitting in this room. And Morehouse, we're only 40 years old. And look at the level of our contribution. Meharry and Howard have a couple of years on us. But this is important. So when you talk about how we contribute, we make a significant contribution. GME, there are 5,594 black residents. Now remember, this is over the years in any given time. Out of the 120,000, so 4.6, and that mirrors the number of practicing physicians. All three HBCUs will train about 498 residents, within about a third, 160 of them graduating every year. So you look at this impact, most of the slots are in primary care. The demographics of our residency programs, though, is about 50% are American grads, and we know at Morehouse School of Medicine, 443% of them are American grads, but many of them are foreign medical graduates. HBCU graduates have 160 slots, as we said. Very interesting data when you start to look at the specialties of our black resident graduates. Primary care, family medicine, internal medicine, obstetrics and gynecology, pediatrics and psychiatry. Now this is looking at the percent of blacks overall, and then this is the percent of blacks residents in the specialty in this color here. And you see the only one that pretty much parallels is OBGYN. The impact is that the top five specialties with black residents our primary care, and we are the only race and ethnicity that does not have surgery in the top five. 18.9% of all black residents are in the field of internal medicine, but only 4.2% of the internal medicine residents are black. We need larger numbers to really make an impact. Our pipeline is not growing. If 4.6% of the residents are black, it mirrors the 4.6% of practicing physicians. So we are not, as you would expect, if our applicant pool is not growing, our matriculant pool is not growing, you would not expect our residency pool to grow. And therefore, we are not going to see an increase in the number of black physicians. And this is just the data showing you this. When you look, emergency medicine, 60% of the non-Hispanic residents in that specialty, okay, and 6.6% for overall. So achieving health equity. Primary care is important. It is important. Lower cost, higher quality, continuity of care, first line of defense and prevention. We believe that primary care is part of the solution. And the reason why minority health professions really play a role in this, on average, regardless of race, and ethnicity. Over 55% of physicians choose to practice non-primary care. However, non-white physicians are more likely to practice primary care than their white counterparts. Nearly a quarter of American Indians are Alaska Natives who practice primary care. And you can see here for blacks, it's about 53.5%. And this is just the data that looks at it by race and ethnicity, and whether you look at it, however you look at it, it's family medicine, pediatrics, or general practice or internal medicine, you will see that blacks have a significant incidence of practicing in those primary care areas. We have a crisis in primary care, so it really does matter that we continue to support primary care, but we also don't want our students to not have the opportunity to practice in any area, because we know how we educate and train them at Morehouse School of Medicine. We educate and train them to be a primary care provider until proven otherwise. So that means they get an education that is supportive of primary care. And even if they go on to be an oculoplastic surgeon or a reproductive endocrinologist, infertility specialist, they would never take that patient to a retriever without ensuring that her blood pressure and her diabetes and her BMI are appropriate, because that's how we educate and train them. Now, why does this matter? It matters for us because we know the leading cause of death in African Americans. We know the infant mortality rate has not really improved. And we know that most of the leading causes of death are preventable through healthy behavior and lifestyle choices and adequate access to primary care. And more importantly, we know that when we educate and train our students, that they are more likely to go practice in those underserved areas where they will be able to make a difference here. So what's the solutions? First of all, we have to recognize the problem. We have to identify the best practices which will lead to increasing the pipeline of opportunities for diverse students. We have to scale and partner with like-minded organizations to make investments. The Henry Fords of the world, the Mayo Clinics of the world. We have to partner with them. If they are truly interested in creating health equity, they will want to partner with HBCU undergraduate schools to ensure that they have a pipeline of diverse students coming to their institutions to train. Now, they have to get to medical school first, but the engagement to get a student to go to a Mayo Clinic in Rochester, a student of color, or to come here to a Henry Ford, should begin in their undergraduate years. And then you partner through a medical school to ensure that you have that pipeline. And then we have to implement programs, we have to monitor, and we have to measure. And the measurement doesn't stop with just how many more students are applying, are matriculating, are graduating. The measurement doesn't stop until we can document the improvement in health outcomes for those communities that we care about and that creation of health equity. For us, at the Minority Serving Institution, we truly believe that education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world, and we're doing it every day. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rice, for a very challenging presentation. Are there questions?
Karen Taylor Crawford, Chicago, Illinois. I'm a graduate of the University of Illinois, Chicago Medical School, undergraduate school. I'm a psychiatrist. Feel many times like I'm a primary care physician when I see my psychiatric patients. But my sister, when you talked about prison pipeline, I just want to know, you testify for me. Because as chairman of a department of a major psychiatry union in Chicago, as a faculty member at the University of Illinois, as an individual who started a adolescent psychiatric inpatient unit, I tried to hire African-American men who were master's degrees or doctoral students who had prison records. Do you know that I was told, not now? Mm-hmm. I had a young man who is at University of Chicago School of Social Science getting his PhD, who was going to do my statistical analysis for a program with adolescents in an African-American urban high school, and they were offended because of his prison record. And I'm like, who better understands how to meet the needs of these young African-American males than a young man who sat in prison, who has come out and is now a doctoral candidate at the University of Chicago? Mm-hmm. People do not want to hear it. And we as African-American physicians, unfortunately, are not, I am not aware of anybody else who has been so sensitive to that issue, because I have seen too many bright, inventive young people who have gotten into the wrong spot. And they didn't even mean to do anything wrong. So thank you, my sister.
I will tell you, I think our president, President Obama, put it best as he was visiting the prisons the other day. And he said, if it were not for the grace of God, if it were not for the grace of God, because when you look at what many of the young men are in prison for, many of you all know, sitting in this audience, if it were not for the, not me, of course, but for the grace of God, some of you all would not be sitting in this seat. And so lest we forget the opportunity. And I have to put a plug in for the Satterhev Leadership Institute and Community Voices and the work that we do to break down the revolving door of men going back to prison and trying to create work opportunities and educational opportunities. This will not change until we change policy. And you all, we do have a voice in making a difference at that with the NMA. We do have a voice. We can, as we get to be the president and the CEOs of our organizations, we can make decisions about our policies and who we will hire, particularly when we're at private institutions. And I think we have to walk the walk and talk the talk. And sometimes we're going to have to step up and give the opportunity. Because if it were not for the grace of God, some of you all would not be sitting here. Not me, but some of you all would not be sitting here. Yes, sir.
Question.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Alan Noonan, a retired public health service officer and public health activist. And I have two questions I'd like to just put on the floor. One, when we talk about diversity, we're also talking about the seats in schools for African-American young people. And if you look at most of the health professions, all of them, no more than 70% of any health profession in HBCUs has African-American students. So those seats go to somebody else. How do we balance that? And the other issue is, as Dr. Sullivan is an activist in, how do we use our expertise to reach out to young people to convince them that health is the way to go?
Thank you for the question. So if you look at Morehouse School of Medicine, we would, if you ask us what percentage of our students are black, it would probably be about 85%. If you ask us which percent of our students are African American, you have to define what you mean by African American also, right? Remember, it is self-selection. People are self-identification. And Mark Navan and I have had a conversation about looking at how we create those checkbox for people to self-identify. Many of us really do believe that it is important to understand what we are saying. So if you are talking about African American or are you talking about people who have a lineage of slavery or coming from this country, the United States, versus someone who may have been their ancestors or their first generation grandparents were born in another country, and even if they were born here. And so I think we are working on what that delineation should be. And then we're asking ourselves the real question is, why does it matter? And part of the reason that it matters, you all, is there is something called acculturation or some other experiences that people have. And now this is getting sensitive, but it's the truth. When you look at some of our Caribbean and Latino, our African heritage individuals, they come to this country, and when they come to this country for an education, they are coming, and they are coming here for that education. They are coming here for that education. That is a different experience, having been born of this country and believing that you have a right to that education. We have a right, as a U.S. citizen, I have a right to be able to go to Harvard or Yale or wherever I want to go, because I was born of this country. And in truth, I have a different level of tenacity in which I may go after that goal, because I've been fooled to believe that that right is going to be extended to me. That's a different level of tenacity of someone who actually had to come over 3,000, 5,000 miles, and their purpose of being here is for that education. And so there's a different mindset. You all, there's a different cultural compass, and we need to be very clear about it. We see it every day at Morehouse School of Medicine. It doesn't mean that we don't welcome those other students, but we also have a responsibility. We were founded to diversify the physician workforce in the state of Georgia and the nation. I have a commitment. There are going to be other little folk who come from Macon, Georgia, or Tennell, Georgia, who are going to have opportunity to go to Morehouse School of Medicine, because that's why we were founded. So, yes.
Microphone. Let me say, there are several people at the microphones, but let me say we'll take one final comment. But during the panel discussion, those others will have the opportunity to raise questions or make comments. So please save your questions for then. But the gentleman at the microphone, he has been for some time.
Thank you. Based on your data that you presented, and putting that in the historical context of the things that you've said, going back, we see a parallel of the Flexner Report of 1907 still present today, because in the Flexner Report it said that the education of the Negro will never wholly be left to the Negro physician, and also that the physician, the Negro physician, now we call the African-American physician, should not be in the specialties, but more in hygiene, and I guess now that's primary care, based on that report. And we also see that what happened is that when the Flexner Report said they increased the women, within 2 years that the women population was increased in medicine, and yet from 1889, where we had a 2.3% of physicians, and what you're showing today in 2015 or 2014, that every diverse group has been moving, increasing in their numbers, but the African American group has not increased in their numbers, and that we're at the point of extinction in the field of medicine, and we're talking these sidebar conversations. So my question is that you said that we now have to stop doing the silence of violence by sitting silently by while violently our kids are not going into medical schools, are being locked out the systems. I'm asking, one, can we do an investigation to see, because we have done a little investigation where we saw the applications were sent into medical schools, but the admissions dean was not aware, that the admissions committee was not aware, but yet the kid has a 3.8 grade point average and 36 on the MCAT scores, African American, both were rejected within 2 weeks to these schools, and that no one knows. So we need to investigate to see administratively, are they being pulled out based on their picture, based on their color, because all the propositions do not go against the admissions of African Americans to the medical school. They only say that you cannot base your admissions on color, and no medical school base it on color. They don't say, I'm letting you in because you're white or Asian, but when it comes to the African American, it seems to be an issue or a problem. Next, in terms, you said in GME, that the GME funding should be first and foremost for Americans studying at home and abroad, not from other people from other places, other worlds and stuff like that. Their country should be supplying them. So they have used those spots to fill other people and talk about diversity at the table when none of them have actually had to fight for human rights, because none of them had ever had to go through chattel slavery, be considered not human beings. But we still have to realize that we are three-fifths humans, and that mindset has to change in the American population so we can sit down at the table as bargainers and not beggars. So I'm asking you that if you send us as an action plan, that we have to first recognize that we are the only race that has suffered enslavement. We're the only race that have had land taken away, removed from land, and that we have a right to this society on this earth to bring about the admissions of African Americans by any means necessary for that equality that has not been done with the 1960 initiative, 1970 initiative, and we still do not have 3%, 12%, that they, here we are making over 12% of the population African Americans, and we're getting ready to be extinct. So do
okay,
we need
no
those
more
plans?
Question, because I'm not going to remember now, so I'm going to get those two.
Okay, very good.
So,
that's it. Thank
so
you.
First of all, thank you for your passion. The reason that we are here having this discussion is because we all feel your passion. And when we get to sit in these seats of president and deans and get rid of and are able to pull back the curtain, a lot of times we see stuff that we weren't aware that was going on. And that we now have the opportunity, because there are many people who are beginning to sit in the seat, that really do recognize the importance of diversity and the importance of who we educate and train. And so Mark Nevey will tell you, I bombard them with getting information from the AAMC. And the reason is that, because I'm a scientist, I believe in evidence. And they have all the data to look at this and to cut the data from multiple perspectives. So when you look at the 500 or so kids who did not match in a residency training program this year, we're looking at what percentage of those are underrepresented minorities. Because we know that some people are doing just what Roy talked about. If your step one or step two scores were not this, then you didn't even get an interview. And then when you got an interview, you didn't get selected because it is a closed system. We got to go behind the curtain. Okay, we know that. We know that we have not seen the growth in applicants. For black males, and please attend the press conference tomorrow at 10 o'clock. We know that our pipeline is leaking. But our pipeline, in order to begin to plug it, you all, we got to start in the third grade. So everything that you're doing in your medical school to try to talk to the undergraduate students, those people are already in the pipeline. That's it, they're there. We have to actually start way back in the third grade and preparing kids to see science and math as their opportunity. Your presence in your third grade class rooms matter. Those kids seeing you matter. That's when we have to start, because we have to fill the pipeline. And then, and I'll put a plug in for our booth. Go to our booth, and we're going to talk about how you can plug up some of the leaks of the pipeline. Go to Morehouse School of Medicine booth, and we're going to talk about how you can plug up some of the leaks in the pipeline. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Montgomery Rice, for that great presentation. I think you've touched a number of chords. Now, let me say that we are going to modify the printed program. We're not going to take a break. Those of you who have to take a break, please take it as you see fit. We're about 15 minutes behind, but we will make up the time. We'll also have our panel afterwards, so we'll have time for further discussion of some of the issues that have already arisen, as well as others. Our next speaker is Mr. William Toby, who will talk about the Affordable Care Act, one of the most significant pieces of legislation in the history of this country, and certainly for the 21st century. Bill Toby, as you may know, is a native of Georgia, but when I was secretary, I had the privilege of appointing him as head of the Healthcare Financing Administration, which is now, of course, CMS. Bill had, prior to that time, been the regional director for HCFA in New York, which included New York, New Jersey, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands. He was an outstanding administrator, overseeing our Medicare and Medicaid programs, working with our Social Security Administration, he remained in the department and served also under Secretary Shalala for a number of years. He's now a private consultant, working with many governments and private organizations in managing, advising on their health care programs, including Medicare and Medicaid. So it's my distinct pleasure to present to you Mr. William Toby, who will talk about the Affordable Care Act.
Thank you, Lou. Thank you. Lou, I assume I still have my 30 minutes while you're dinner adjusting. I'm very thrilled to be here. I want to thank the National Medical Association for your extraordinary hospitality. I was here yesterday and I attended the historical event with four Surgeon Generals and a sitting Surgeon General as well. And for those of you who don't know, I spent 32 years in the Federal Department of Health and Human Services. And I can tell you, I just want to echo what Dr. Sullivan said, this particular summit yesterday and today is very historical, and very historical to have the former Surgeon Generals here to talk about their experiences and to have a sitting Surgeon General as well. I had never seen that before, and as I said, I spent 32 years in the federal government working with Surgeon Generals, but you all had the benefit of getting their insights and to getting their experience and their particular recommendations about how to address American medicine. I was very happy to see that. Whenever I attend a session like this, and I'm amongst such an august body as we have here, I have really witnessed some of the smartest people in America in this room yesterday and today. And I want to compliment you. But when I do this, I always remember and I reflect about my life. And I reflect about my mother and my father. And my mother in particular, would be so excited that I'm here today. She's deceased. My father would never believe I was among such august body. And let me explain why. I dropped out of, my father never finished the first grade. My father couldn't read or write. My mother couldn't read or write. And so they had great expectations for me. And I dropped out, as Lou just said, I was born and raised in Georgia until I was 8 years old. And in 1948, my family moved to New York City, where I have been ever since. But Georgia is still part of my soul. And I can tell you that because I dropped out of high school, my father, I broke his heart because he thought, my God, that is the end of him. And in 1992, I received a phone call from Dr. Sullivan asking me if I would take over the Healthcare Financing Administration. And I agreed to do so. And I spent 18 months at the Healthcare Financing Administration. And while I was there, several events occurred similar to, and reminds me of what Roy Wilson was talking about. Roy was talking about if you want to have diversity in large institutions, you're going to have to be at the table, you're going to have to be at the top. When I arrived at CMS, just give me an example. When I arrived there in 1992, at my first staff meeting, my executive staff meeting, now mind you, we are managing, or we're managing the largest healthcare agency in the world for the beneficiaries, Medicare and Medicaid beneficiaries. And I'm at the executive staff meeting, and nobody in that room looked like me. Nobody in that room looked like our beneficiaries. So I looked around the room and I said, I'm glad to be here. I'm your new administrator. But this room is a little too milky for me. That was my first day. I said, I know not one of you is a racist. You're all good people. But why is this room so milky? And I want you to know that I trust you, but for the term of my administration here, appointed by Dr. Sullivan, I'm stopping all promotions. Nobody will get promoted in this agency until I see affirmative action on its way. I stayed for 18 months, and when I left the executive staff, below the executive staff, they looked like America. When Dr. Sullivan left, I assumed I would be fired as well, but as Dr. Sullivan said, Donna Shalala and President Clinton asked me to stay on, and I stayed on for 6 more months. And that was a source of pride for me and a source of pride for Dr. Sullivan. And I have to say to you that I'm so happy that today I can thank Dr. Sullivan for his judgment, for his passion for diversity in the highest reaches of the federal government. And he deserves a round of applause because we control that department. If you go there today, you won't see it. Believe me, it's back to where it was before. Let me also, as the former chief of Medicare and Medicaid, appointed by Dr. Sullivan, as he said, let me acknowledge that 4 days ago, just 4 days ago, Medicare and Medicaid actually had a 50th birthday and major celebrations in Washington. And these programs, as you probably know, this year, 2015, will have given access to 119 million beneficiaries. Until 1 month ago, I was totally unaware of the historical role that the National Medical Association played in the birth of Medicare. I had no idea. And then I got a call from Dr. Jackson, who wanted to talk about my travel plans to come to this meeting. And he asked me, what was I doing? And I said, well, I'm basically getting ready for an oral history project by the National Academy of Social Sciences. The Academy wanted to interview me because I was one of the people who implemented Medicare and Medicaid in 1967. It was 1 year old. And so he said to me, are you aware that the NMA played a major role in Medicare creation? And I said, no, I've never seen anything about it. So we had a conversation about the history of your involvement in Medicare and Medicaid creation. So there was nothing in the literature about it that I saw, but I can tell you, I knew the literature about the American Medical Association. I knew that they had fought against Medicare. I knew that they had hired a Hollywood actor by the name of Ronald Reagan. And he had said that Medicare was a socialized experiment practiced by a government who wanted to change the lives of little children and make them communist. So I knew about that. I also knew that the American Medical Association held delayed the implementation of Medicare and Medicaid for 3 long years. They were very effective from 1962 to 1965. They stopped it. But I didn't know about what you all had done. So for the AMNMA, for your leadership, your vision, your commitment to justice, and being on the right side of history, I'm thrilled to be here to thank you on behalf of the 119 Medicare beneficiaries. Now, Dr. Sullivan is a tough taskmaster, and I'll get on with my presentation, but there's one last thing I have to tell you that leads right into my presentation. In December of 1993, I was privileged to accompany Dr. Sullivan to Paris, France. Dr. Sullivan was going to Paris, France to meet with the ministers of health of France, England, Germany, Australia, and Canada. Dr. Sullivan, as you know, is a very gracious man. So what did he do? He decided to hold a lunch for his fellow ministers. Remember, Lou? He held a magnificent lunch for the ministers of health in France, Germany, England, Australia, and Canada. And he asked me at that luncheon to make a presentation on a very important policy issue that we were grappling with. So what did I choose? I chose the Oregon Health Plan. I'm sure some of you remember the Oregon Health Plan. Very controversial. It was on his desk for a long time. So I spoke for 15 minutes about the Oregon Health Plan. I described what it was about, and I waited for these questions to come. And when the questions came, they weren't about the Oregon Health Plan. They peppered me with questions about, tell us why in your rich country you have 30 million people uninsured. 30 million, why? They asked us, why do your people cross the border into Canada to buy their drugs? Why do your people cross into Canada for other kinds of healthcare services? Why do you go to Mexico? And I said, okay, let me educate them about it. I explained our tradition, which prevents us from giving access to people and coverage, giving them coverage. I explained it. We have 50 states. Everybody is different in terms of culture. We have different religions. And when you talk about healthcare in America, everything is very controversial. So I still felt very humiliated. Dr. Sullivan had bought the lunch. They had eaten our food. And now they were humiliating us. So I'm thinking, America rescued these people from the Nazis during World War II. We created the Marshall Plan. So why am I being humiliated? We rebuilt their economies. And yet there in Paris, I felt the failure of our country to provide access to 30 million people. I felt that was a stain on our honor. I felt it was a stain on our system of values. But that wasn't the end of the story. When President Johnson signed the Medicare and Medicaid legislation in 1965, he said, great vision. The New York Times covered the ceremony in Washington last week on the anniversary of Medicare and Medicaid. And Bob, some of you may have heard of Bob Perry of the Times. He came over and asked me, what was the relationship between the Affordable Care Act and the Medicare creation? And I said it was the promise that President Johnson made. He said, when I signed this legislation today for Medicare and Medicaid, it is not the end, because we need coverage for people under age 65. And so that's what I'm going to talk about now, the Affordable Care Act. And, okay, here's a picture here, and I don't have a pointer and probably don't need one, but here's a picture on March 3rd, 2010, President Obama signing the Affordable Care Act. Now, most of you know that in so doing, he accomplished, President Obama, I, like others like you in this room, we waited 40 years for this kind of health care reform. When he signed this legislation, what he did was he made the promise of Teddy Roosevelt come true. Teddy Roosevelt had wanted the same thing, but he couldn't get it. So Obama accomplished something that had not been accomplished in 100 years. 100 years. The Affordable Care Act, and I may shorten it to saying ACA, so just follow me, but it's the most fundamental legislative change in access and coverage in the 50 years since Medicare and Medicaid was created. Paul Krugman of the New York Times recently argued that the direct benefits of the Affordable Care Act for the health and financial security of Americans are so large that just establishing that the Affordable Care Act did no harm, economic harm that is, because the Republicans were saying it was a job killer, it would be sufficient to justify it. And I have to say to you that what Obama accomplished, what he accomplished, I think is so frightening to some people in this country because they're afraid it just might work. If it really works, I'm talking about working from the standpoint of the objectives that were set for the program, that if it works, that he will be held in such esteem that his picture will go, I mean, his sculpture, I say, face will go on Mount Rushmore. That's what they're afraid of. So what I'm going to do is say this program is just more than just the economic importance. I'm going to talk about what the benefits really are. But first, I want you to understand what the Affordable Care Act does not do, because too many people see it as the beginning and the end, and it is not. So let me talk about what it is not. ACA is not national health insurance. It is not the Clinton plan, which I was a part of in Washington when I was left for 6 months to work on it. It is not that. It is not a national health insurance plan, because if it were a national health insurance plan, you wouldn't have 2,700 pages, so complex that you have to be a doctor to understand it. 2,700 pages. If it were national health insurance, it would be maybe 500 pages because it would be a single payer. So it is not national health insurance. The Affordable Care Act does nothing to fix our fragmented and uncoordinated health care system. If you are a Hispanic, if you are a black man or woman, and you live in an urban neighborhood, and you get sick at 3 o'clock in the morning, your only choice is a safety net hospital. I'm thinking, when as I speak, about Brooklyn. I'm thinking about 2.5 million people in Brooklyn. I'm thinking about the fact that half of the people in Brooklyn, 50%, are on Medicaid. When they get sick, there is nothing, no place for them to go. except a hospital. There is no primary care system at all. This is because our legacy of our country is that we have not invested in primary care, and we have not invested in community-based specialty care. And so the poor people in Brooklyn, most of them are minorities, and we're talking about people with obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and they end up in a hospital, chronic disease, and that is a hospital is the worst place to be if you have a chronic disease. And I'm sure you'll agree with that. So ACA, it doesn't fix that. Under ACA, you should understand that public hospitals are losing vital, uncompensated care monies. I find that extremely worrisome. Public hospitals are in a crisis. Dr. Sullivan talks to me about this all the time, especially hospital like Grady, Harlem Hospital in New York, it used to be Cook County in Chicago, I guess. These institutions are already facing, they depend on public money. You and I know, public money. You take away compensated, uncompensated care, and they're in trouble, real trouble. So you need to think about this. Affordable Care Act is going to need a lot of amendments. It's going to need a lot of changes. But one of the things you need to understand is that uncompensated care funds need to be untouched, and you need to fight for that. That's very important. So ACA does a lot of good, and I will walk you through those elements. And most people, when they talk about ACA, they talk about it in ways in which I want to describe today. But first, I'm going to talk about three things. I'm going to talk about the architecture of ACA. I'm going to talk about what I think has happened over the last 5 years. And I'm going to hopefully give you some insight into a future outlook. So let's talk about the Affordable Care Act. It's been described by the policy wonks as a three-legged stool. And by that they mean there is coverage, there is insurance reform, and then we have subsidies. And so the fact that you have the subsidies to make all of this happen, to get people covered, is what makes it very, very effective. So that's just about it, and it's just about it. Insurance reform, coverage, and having subsidies. Now, some of you are going to say, what about other goals and objectives? They are there, and the bill, the legislation, if you've looked at it, and many of you have, I'm sure not many have read 2,700 pages, but if you look at ACA, it's very complex. As I said, 2,700 pages. It also covers a vast territory. There are 10 titles on the ACA, aside from the structure I just laid out, 10 titles. One of the titles has been taken away, and that's Title 8, which is long-term care. That was taken out because the Obama administration couldn't find the money to fund it. So there are now 9 titles. Title 4 is what Dr. Satcher talked about yesterday very eloquently. Title 4 has to do with prevention and public health. I think Dr. Foster talked yesterday about Title 5, which has to do with workforce. So those are the goals and objectives of the law. But again, the theme of the Affordable Care Act is just insurance reform and coverage. Obama wanted to get people covered. All these other things are important, but they're not the number one issue as far as he was concerned. He wanted to get people covered. If other things happened that were good, fine. First, let me just walk you through how the law has played out. Now, I need to make it very clear, as a person who ran CMS for years, I want to make it very clear that the CMS staff have worked very, very hard to make this legislation work. The issue has been, what is the meaning of this legislation? This is what CMS had to work on and make some sense of. And people like Dr. Dr. David Satcher and others, I'm sure, are very busy trying to help the regulator, people who write regulations, work very hard on this and make it meaningful to all of you. But how has it played out? Let me give you a progress report. Number one, there's a lot, the ACA gives about $10 billion to do innovative things. So at this moment, CMS has implemented quite a few demonstration projects. And they're demonstrating all over the place with regard mostly around payment reform. The belief is if you have payment reform, you can change the healthcare delivery system. They have also established, and I'm very proud of this, a lot of ACOs, and that has been discussed with you, by all of you, which is to integrate the healthcare system so that patients get better care. It has also established an office of coordination care that is already up and running to take care of the dual eligible population, at least put the policy focus on it. They have, in addition to that, they have worked very hard on transparency rules dealing with quality and pricing. And they deserve great credit for that. But coming back to establishing an Office of Innovation, which they've done, which is very important, when Dr. Sullivan and I learned about, I called Dr. Sullivan about it, and I said, Dr. Sullivan, they have $10 billion. Remember, Lou? $10 billion. I hope some of you got some of that money. I'm sure Dr. Satcher did, but I hope some of you got some of that money. Roy, I don't know whether your university got any of it, but I can tell you it is being utilized. So that's one important thing they've done. So over the last, what is surprising in terms of how things have played out is that 5 years after implementation, half the people are still against the program, which is so surprising. 5 years later, half Americans do not like the program. They're opposed to it. I watch on television and cry when I see these little mothers in West Virginia, in the mountains of West Virginia, talk about they saw a doctor for the first time. And the reporters say, my God, do you know how you got this service? Oh no, I don't know, it's a wonderful service. But this is Obamacare. And I heard this woman say, oh no, it can't be. I hate Obamacare. And she was getting all this prenatal care. So we know why part of the reason that people are opposed to this program is because the Obama administration did not explain it. They didn't do it. Dr. Sullivan and I had conversations constantly. Why aren't they explaining the program? People don't understand it. It's too complex. Why isn't the White House explaining it? I was at a meeting with HHS Secretary Sylvia Matthews last week, and for the first time, Dr. Sullivan, she admitted publicly for everybody that they made a mistake. They didn't sell the program. Dr. Sullivan was so anxious, he wanted to go down to Washington and sell it himself. So the second, and the other reason I mentioned earlier that the people are still opposed to it, some of the people who are opposed to it really understand it, and so any explaining won't help because they're ideologues. But they're the ones, I said, who are afraid that Obama will end up on Mount Rushmore. They are very scared. The second thing that has happened is that the House Republicans have spent a lot of time over the past 5 years. Can you imagine spending time trying to defund or repeal Obamacare? Instead of fixing our infrastructure, they are trying to repeal and deny funds to Obamacare. 54 times the House has voted to repeal or deny the care. And believe me, the fight is not over. Right now, the danger is they have come up with a system of trying to take the Obamacare legislation, put it into, they're putting it into a measure that after, probably in September, so when they come back from vacation, they are going to put it in a reconciliation bill. A reconciliation bill is a bill in which you can hide everything. Nobody can really see what you're voting on. They want to put repeal into that. So it's not over yet. They also have complained a great deal, the Republicans, about the fact that Obama said things that were not true, such as, you know, they use that. I think he once said that if you like your plan, you can keep it, and nobody is going to, you know, was $2,500, I think he said it was going to save. Well, none of that was true, so they've used that against him as well. Now, I want to talk about the marketplace, because my time is going to be out soon here. I want to talk about Medicaid expansion. This is the part that I think, this is the central part of the law, Medicaid expansion. The hope was that 16 million people under Medicaid would be covered. And as you know, the states are fighting against it. And that is very surprising to me. It's surprising to me because I spent 30 years working with states, and I have never known a state to give up federal funds. They are giving up 100% of funding until the end of 2016. 100% of funding after 2016, 90% of funding in perpetuity. They are giving that money up. And you ask yourself, why are they doing this? And I'm sure their budget directors, knowing that they have deficits, knowing that Medicaid is 14-15% of their budget, that the budget directors are trying to talk them into accepting Medicaid. But for right now, they're not doing it. If you look at the Medicaid, the states where they are opposing the expansion, you would not be surprised that in those states, the uninsured are mostly Black Americans and Hispanics. African Americans are 19% of the uninsured. 19%. So this is our issue. The impact of non-implementation of Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act hurts us, and it hurts our people, because we're the ones being left out. and not getting that wonderful coverage that the Surgeon General has talked about yesterday to make a difference in the lives of our people. So we have got to fight for that. The other thing I want to talk about is that I want to keep on time here. Insurance reform, you all know about that very much so. It's in the newspapers all the time. But under ACA, quality is a very important thing, and CMS is really proud of what they're doing in terms of improving care under ACA. And they are very important. The very important thing they've done has been is actually getting reductions in the hospitals where the incidence of acquired conditions have fallen about 17%. Hospital readmissions have declined sharply. All these good things are happening because of the Affordable Care Act. The other thing that is happening is that under the Affordable Care Act, some of you probably live in those states in where ACA is providing funds under what they call DSRIP. New York State always gets the lion's share of any money to do demonstrations, to do research. DSRIP is an opportunity to change the healthcare delivery system under Medicaid. As many of you know, since 1965, it always has been Medicare leading the way. But right now, Medicaid, for the last 20 years, has been leading the way in terms of healthcare reform. Now, as physicians, one of the things that ACA is trying to do is to give incentives to doctors through states to allow them to bundle payments, allow them under ACA wide discretion to actually give benefits and payment systems in which doctors won't have to fill out a lot of papers, where the doctors get a better reimbursement rate. So you will probably benefit from this kind of advancement in terms of payment reform. Let me just end up and take questions here in terms of future outlook. As I look at the future with regard to the Affordable Care Act, my sense is over the next, like Medicare, we're looking for the next 10 or 50 years, but I think over the next 3 or 4 to 5 years, I'm worried very much about minority physicians, black physicians in particular. I'm worried about how you're going to fare under this law. Because if you're a solo practitioner, you only have two or three members of your staff. When this law was passed in 2010, the belief was that you were going to get all these new patients. Right now, because of the way the states are contracting out with providers, providers are determining who is going to be part of their network. They're looking at the cost of providers who come into their network, and they're going to exclude minority doctors, I think, from the system. So I think in the next 3 or 4 years, it's a big danger for minority physicians at this, unless you merge with other groups. It's going to be a problem. And I see ACA as being very active in cost savings because, as you know, healthcare cost is going down at this juncture, and that's very, very good. I think on the Medicare expansion, I think you can feel better about it because I'm looking at Medicare and Medicaid 47 years ago when they were implemented. I think some of these governors are going to come aboard. When Medicaid, some of you may remember, when Medicaid was implemented in 1965, during the first year, only about half the states came in. In the second year, The other half of the states came in. Only one state held out forever, and that was Arizona. Arizona came into the system in 1982. Can you imagine? Not 1965, 1982. Recently, you probably read about the fact Alaska has decided to come under to do Medicaid expansion, and that gives me hope. So I think the GOP governors are very slowly expanding, but Alaska is a good example. I expect a lot of legal challenges to come in the future, but I think we will survive it as we've survived all hardships in the past. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Toby, for that comprehensive view of the Affordable Care Act. We'll take a few questions. Dr. Satcher.
First, excuse me, thanks very much for outstanding presentation and for your outstanding career.
Thank you.
Obviously owe you a lot, and I want to make that clear. However, I didn't stand up here just to praise you. I have one question. I have a little difficulty with your statement that the Affordable Care Act does nothing about better coordination of an uncoordinated healthcare system. Somebody agrees with me, apparently. But I think there are three ways, and I'd like your reaction, three ways in which the Affordable Care Act attempts to improve coordination. One is by supporting primary care providers. I think incentivizing primary care in terms of incentive salaries, supporting primary care residency programs, all of the efforts to enhance primary care, I see as one way of improving coordination of the health system, because that's how we see primary care. The second component of that would be the electronic health record. The Affordable Care Act incentivizes the use of the electronic health record, and I guess what they call it in Medicare is meaning for use. In Medicare, if you can show that you're using electronic health record and it's making a difference, say you're trying to control hypertension, and you can show that through use of the electronic health record and communicating with colleagues, you can improve the control, that's meaning for use. It's not just using it. Our concern about that, of course, is that many of the physicians who serve our communities may have the most difficulties getting on board with electronic health records. The third way that we believe that the Affordable Care Act enhances coordination is by supporting accountable care organizations, pulling together providers and hospitals. And the accountable care organization strategy is intended to be a strategy for improving the coordination of healthcare. And I'd like for you to respond to that, because that was the only problem I really had.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Satcher. I was aware you were in the room, and of course I was nervous. Let me speak about the HIT, the health and technology part of it now. It is absolutely true that the Affordable Care Act is doing a lot with regard to providers and the use of HIT. That's electronic health records, it's doing that. There's no question about it. And I think in doing that, it is going to move our country and our providers closer to Asia and Europe, because as you know, they're already there. We've always been behind. I agree on that. But let me clarify what I meant. In better coordination, there's no question about it. More patient-centered care, no doubt about it. I was speaking, and by the way, when I spoke about ACOs and happy about it being established, I don't see the ACOs as doing anything for our people. ACOs, that's a middle class benefit. It's not doing anything for the people I know in Bedford-Stuyvesant and what have you. It's good to integrate in care, but they're not doing that in ACOs for our people. Let me clarify what I meant when I said it won't do anything. What I said was the Affordable Care Act won't do anything for a fragmented system like we have in Bedford-Stuyvesant, Brooklyn, where I'm a part of the Berger Commission, and we just finished 2 years ago a major study of healthcare deliveries and payment problems in that area. So in that area, if you get sick at 3 a.m, as I said, and you need a doctor, you have to go to a hospital. And many times, if you go to that hospital, you may not have a condition that requires you to be in a hospital. You maybe should be in a clinic or something. So there is no system at this point for this. And consequently, you are totally dependent on a hospital if you live in an urban area, and that is not right. I do think eventually on the DSRIP, there is money to move toward primary care, but I think people are doing that outside of the Affordable Care Act. People like you already doing it and have been doing it. And that's what I meant by that, that I'm thinking about people living in urban neighborhoods where they have to depend on a hospital for their care, and it's the worst place to be if you have chronic diseases. And most, 65% of Medicare beneficiaries have chronic diseases. They have no business in a hospital.
Question.
My name is Dr. Emil Commodore. I happen to lead an accountable care organization in Florida. In fact, I know of only two other African-American-led accountable care organizations. One is Morehouse, and the other is an organization. But long story short, three I know of out of over 400 Medicare accountable care organizations. Our organization is physician, primary care physician-based. We have over 30 primary care providers, and we have been able to help these providers to overcome some of the demands made upon them in terms of reporting, in terms of quality of care, in terms of lowering costs. And we were one of the only 48 accountable care organizations that did save money and get paid a bonus from Medicare. So we're very fortunate and pleased to have done that. We saved them over $5 million.
Well,
and as a result, we were able to, so in other words, what I'm saying is that it can work for minority physicians. They didn't believe it could work, but we believe we can do it. And I think the important thing is for these providers to form their own organizations, align themselves into accountable care organizations, because that is the only way they're going to be able to take advantage of those things in the Affordable Care Act that allow them to enhance their income, and as well as prepare for some of the other changes. The only other question I had about you, have for you, is what is DSRIP? You mentioned that. I didn't know exactly.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, DSRIP is part of the Affordable Care Act. It allows for CMS to give money to contractors or to states, I'm sorry, to states or for the most part to undertake efforts to completely restructure the delivery system. In other words, they get waivers that allow payment reform, they get waivers to restructure the program away from all the over-rigid regulations. So they're kind of free to innovate. New York State, for example, just gave out $6.4 billion to 19 providers, $6.4 billion. I'm co-chair of the New York State DSRIP. It means delivery system, delivery system reform incentives program. And Governor Cuomo appointed me last year as co-chair of this transformation. And we gave $6.4 billion to hospitals. Of the 19 groups, 18 were hospitals, and one was a physician group. But they were given this money, lots of money, to basically contract out with other providers at the local level, and Dr. Satcher will like this, to do really bring public mental health together with primary care, for example, which is a big deal. And I talked to Dr. Satcher about that yesterday. They also are trying to provide settings, home care settings, all that, to experiment to get more patient-centered care. It's an extraordinary program. It's in 6 states, called the Delivery System Reform Incentive Program, DSRIP. And CMS had $10 billion to do this.
Let me say, I think we need to go on to our next speaker, but please, those who are standing, come back during our panel discussion with your questions. We'll have a chance for that exchange. So, Bill, thank you very much for your presentation. We'll now hear from the president of the American College of Physicians, the largest professional association of physicians in the country, Dr. Wayne Riley, who's serving as president of that organization, is, first of all, a graduate of Yale for his undergraduate work and a graduate of the Morehouse School of Medicine, where he learned, where he became a physician. He also served as vice president for Baylor Medical Center and president at Meharry Medical College for 7 years. So he has provided great leadership and continues to do so, and he's going to give the perspective of the American College of Physicians and the practicing physicians on the Affordable Care Act. Dr. Riley.
Good morning. I am honored to be here this morning. As Lou mentioned, I had the honor of a lifetime to lead Meharry, and I now have the wonderful honor to lead the nation's largest medical specialty society. I first want to acknowledge the fact that I am a Thank You Lottie graduate of Morehouse School of Medicine, and I know some of you, I see some of you in the audience, and I also want to welcome the Meharrians who I got to know during my tenure. Dr. Sullivan is my life protege, and I've always taken my cues from him in terms of my activities as a physician to make sure that I am paying back. And one of the things that all three speakers, and when we have the discussion, I want to move quickly through my slides because the professor in me tells me there's a lot of pent-up questions and dialogue that we need to get to. But just want to underscore the fact that Bill showed this picture earlier, President Johnson signing the Medicare bill, sitting next to President Truman. You can't see the audience, but the NMA was there. NMA leadership was at the Truman Library that day when President Johnson signed the bill. AMA leadership was not there. The President of the United States was mighty ticked off at the American Medical Association for their strong opposition to Medicare. That strong opposition took the voice of a future President of the United States, as Bill mentioned. Ronald Wilson Reagan was the chief spokesperson against the Medicare bill. And if you've ever heard the recordings of President Reagan when he was really hammering the Johnson administration and raising the specter of communists coming over the hospital walls to take over American health care, it's pretty chilling. But in some respects, we've made progress. The AMA was here the day that President Obama signed the Affordable Care Act. So was the NMA. So was the organization I'm honored to lead now, the American College of Physicians. So was the American Public Health Association. And I think George's Benjamin may be here at the meeting, but they gave great leadership. And I would really argue that the three biggest proponents of the Affordable Care Act were the NMA, the ACP, and the American Public Health Association. Among all the medical associations, we went all in for the Affordable Care Act. Now, we're dealing with another Ronald Reagan-type phenomenon, as Bill mentioned here. We have strong opposition from the southern governors. And this is the importance of it, colleagues. From Tyler, Texas, you can draw a line through Tyler, Texas to Beaumont, and then across to the Tidewater area of Virginia. That is where Medicaid expansion needs to occur. And as the president of the American College of Physicians, I spend a lot of time in state capitals and on Capitol Hill trying to get recalcitrant governors to come to their senses, as Bill says, to take the money. And I can only characterize it after a number of conversations with governors and members of Congress from the South that they have an acute case of Obama derangement syndrome. They just cannot get past clear evidence that this thing is going to work. And they say, well, Dr. Riley, Medicaid is a terrible program. I said, well, Congressman or Governor, Medicaid may not be perfect, but from the communities that I represent and that I know, Medicaid will help significantly. So colleagues, we have to get off the bench and really vigorously advocate for Medicaid expansion. Now, I know I'm a son of a physician. My late father was an inner city general surgeon. That means he took care of appendectomies and everything in between. And much to my mother's chagrin, he declared bankruptcy twice because his practice was predominantly Medicaid. But we have to get this into our communities because we know that it takes care of people that we care about, and we at the American College of Physicians, again, are all in on Medicaid expansion. Again, our organization, founded in 1915, 142,000 members, we're the second only to the AMA in terms of membership. At a time where I am the third African-American president in 100 years of this organization, that is truly a, thank you. 50 years ago at an NMA meeting, it never could have imagined that you could have an African-American president of the ACP. And so I take that responsibility quite seriously. We've had two other outstanding African-American presidents of the ACP. The first being Gerald Thompson, the legendary chief of medicine at Harlem Hospital, who served from 1995 to 96, and the second, Charles K. Francis, who served from 2002 to 2003. In addition, we've honored one of the giants of African-American medicine, W. Lester Henry, who is the first master and regent of the American College of Physicians, and as you know, the legendary chair of internal medicine at Howard. We have a national award named after Dr. Henry, which I was pleased to chair the awards committee that designated our award for diversity and inclusion, of which our first recipient was Secretary Sullivan. Bill has gone through the statistics on the Affordable Care Act. I want to shift to something else. We take a very broad, progressive view, and I will argue that the ACP is probably the most progressive of the American Medical Specialty Societies. I will be in Charleston, South Carolina on December 4th, the six-month anniversary of the murder of the Emanuel Nine, representing the ACP at a major summit of major organizations that have come forward, and we put out a policy paper on firearm violence. Chattanooga, Charleston, Lafayette, Louisiana, Aurora, Colorado, Sandy Hook, it goes on and on. The common thread through all three of these sad events in American history is that individuals should not have had access to guns. Or if they did have access to guns, they didn't need to be AK-47s with extra bullets easily attainable. So again, this is a particularly forward-leaning position that a major American medical society is taking about firearms. And I will be in Charleston along with the APHA and the American Bar Association, and now 43 other medical organizations, including the NMA, have signed on to try to do something about firearm violence. I need not tell you what it's doing to our communities. Secondly, we have long-standing policy about healthcare disparities. We were one of the first non-minority organizations to have a broad, strong statement on healthcare disparities. We didn't stop there. In March, we put out a seminal policy paper on health equity for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender patients. Again, very forward-leaning to take care of the American public. So we don't just talk the talk, we walk the talk in terms of healthcare disparities. And we know that we are among the first major medical organizations to really put out evidence that there's widespread and significant health care disparities in patient groups. Correctional health care, I'm glad to see Woody Myers here. We have policy on correctional health care. He leads one of the best high-quality providers of correctional health services in the country. We've had long-standing policy about correctional medicine. Again, that's important to those of us in African-American communities because of the makeup of prison populations. So we want to make sure that folks get the best care they can while they are incarcerated. Now, let's shift to cost. Little known fact, we all remember the fact that President Johnson was so pleased with the NMA that in 1968 he flew down to Houston, Texas on Air Force One before he went to his ranch. And he really went to thank the NMA because the NMA was the first medical organization to support Medicare. But President Johnson also was the first American president to start openly articulating concern about cost when he said, now we just must make it more efficient. There's no room for waste in Medicare. And he goes on and on to say that he needs the help of the profession. He's asking the NMA on August 19, 1968 to help with the whole issues of cost. Because within 3 years, Bill Tobey will tell you, they started to see trends in terms of the use of healthcare services that became very concerning to the budget writers in the federal government. So here is the President of the United States at the NMA meeting raising the issue for the first time about the cost of healthcare, in spite of the fact that the great victory of the implementation of Medicare was why he was there in the first place to thank the NMA and its leadership. You've seen this graph before. We have cost issues in medicine. And that's going to be with us the rest of our lives and our careers, colleagues. So it's not anything that we can get away from. But we want thoughtful approaches to cost control and to make sure that cost does not get compromised for quality. The cost domains, again, are well known to you. Unnecessary services, over-testing, inefficient, excess administrative costs, fraud, missed prevention opportunities. All of those are real costs to the healthcare system that those of us in the House of Medicine must grapple with in the years ahead. Again, we take very broad view of our responsibility as the nation's largest medical specialty society to dig deep into issues of public policy, healthcare disparities, effective screening. We released a wonderful paper on behavioral health and trying to get behavioral health into the primary care setting. We have policy coming out in the next few weeks on telemedicine, a innovation in the way that physicians practice that African-American physicians cannot be left behind pursuing. Retail clinics. We all know what's happening at our corner drugstores, but there is a role, an appropriate role for physicians, and I hope the NMA will look at this too, to make sure that our members have access to the referral networks that will be needed to take care of patients who present to referral clinics for more extensive and more serious conditions that require higher level care. Direct contracting, that's concierge practice. Rarity in some of our communities, but again, it's an opportunity that African-American physicians should avail themselves of if they wish. And we put out a strong policy statement last week under my signature on vaccination policy that there should be very few medical exemptions for immunizations so to forestall some of the problems we've seen in California and some of the other states. This is the 100th anniversary of the ACP, so I am honored to be the 91st president in those 100 years and to participate with all the medical organizations, particularly this one. And I salute the NMA. I see President Sanders there, and I hope President-elect Mitchell is here. The ACP is standing shoulder to shoulder to you with as one of the most progressive of the non-minority medical organizations, and it's an honor for me to be here to represent the ACP and to work with all of you. Thank you. I think we want to proceed to the panel because we have so much rich dialogue to have. Yes.
Good morning, and thank you, Dr. Riley. I wanted to reintroduce myself to you. I'm Dr. Kamara Jones, and I'm the president-elect of the American Public Health Association.
Outstanding.
So when you talk about NMA and ACP and APHA, here we are. And I wanted to, I was...
You're one of the big three, the support of the
Absolutely, HR. Absolutely. And what we're about to engage in is APHA in collaboration with NMA so far, and I hope with ACP and with about six other organizations that have already signed on board, we're going to engage on a national campaign against racism, where we define racism... Thank you.
Excellent.
Where we define racism as a system of structuring opportunity and assigning value based on the social interpretation of how we look, which is what we call race, that unfairly disadvantages some individuals and communities, unfairly advantages other individuals and communities, and saps the strength of the whole society through the waste of human resources. I want to say that we recognize we have to address racism and other systems of structured inequity if we're going to achieve health equity, because achieving health equity requires valuing all individuals and populations equally, recognizing and rectifying historical injustices, and providing resources according to need. There's an international anti-racism treaty that most people don't know about. If the ACP and NMA and APHA and all of the other organizations can even let the U.S. population know that the U.S. government signed this international anti-racism treaty in 66. The Senate ratified it 28 years later in 94. We, our State Department, writes periodic reports every 6 years to a UN committee that sends us back what we're supposed to do to make things right, to be right under this treaty. All of this is going to be involved in the partnership, and I look forward to talking to
Excellent.
You in more detail. I'm sure
Great.
That you guys will be
Great.
Willing to sign on. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you so much. Want to proceed to the panel now? Yeah, let's proceed to the panel.
Yes, with that, will the other panelists please come forward? And while they do, why don't our person at the microphone present your question? And you might indicate, if you wish, to whom you'd wish to direct the question, or whether it should be to the entire panel.
Yes. Sure, thank you. My name is Karen Wingfield. I'm a radiation oncologist at Massachusetts General Hospital and on faculty at Harvard Medical School. This question is actually for the entire panel. As an oncologist, we see the increasing burden of cancer in the entire United States, with over 1.5 million cases being seen annually. At a cost over $250 billion to the U.S. Economy, with the greatest burden being in the black community. Across all disease entities, blacks have a higher mortality from cancer, and yet oftentimes cancer is somehow kind of pushed to side. I happen to be in a state where cancer is the number one killer. Massachusetts, and in fact, in the United States, it will quickly become the number one killer as we're doing better with controlling the chronic disease of heart disease. So frankly, my questions are really severalfold. I happen to be the current chair of the Health Access and Training Subcommittee for ASTRO, which is the American Society for Radiation Oncology, and the chair-elect for the American Society of Clinical Oncology, or ASCO. They have a health disparities committee, and hopefully one of the questions actually I have for Dr. Riley is this question of how the ACP can join with both ASTRO and ASCO in terms of helping perhaps more of our primary care physicians to understand the importance of screening, particularly for minority populations, how we might be able to partner to do that, both in terms of educating providers about the importance of screening, that many of the U.S. Preventive Task Force recommendations that came out do not apply to blacks because blacks were a minority of the studies that looked at those kind of screening, particularly for men, black men with prostate cancer, just doesn't apply. And so how can we partner to educate our providers, our colleagues, particularly colleagues who are not of color about that? My question for Mr. Toby is really related to Medicaid expansion. Medicaid expansion with respect to oncologic care.
Let's take one question at a time. So,
okay.
Why don't we have Dr. Riley respond?
Okay.
And also, let's give the other
yeah.
questioners an opportunity. So if you don't mind, once this question is answered, we'll go to the others, but certainly if you get in line again.
May I just
But we don't want to have one person monopolize the questions.
And it's all about oncology and just the oncology workforce. So thank you.
Thank you for your question. We have been very interested in screening at the American College of Physicians. As you know, we put out at least one or two position papers. It's sort of a tale of two cities. There are some aspects to screening in which we screen too much, and then there are some communities and individuals for which we screen too least. And so what we have advocated and what I have spoken on is what we refer to as the right test at the right moment for the right patient. And that would include patients who would be considered non-average risk. An African-American male is not considered non-average risk. An African-American female is not considered average risk for breast cancer. So again, our policy statement it allows for the degree of freedom to approach or have that conversation with your individual patient. Now, the problem with the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendation, as I understand it, their recommendations are graded A, B, C. There are some that are concerned to NMA members that have been labeled as C recommendations. That does not mean they cannot be done. But the problem is the insurance panels will not cover C recommendations. So that's where we have advocated all along that reimbursement and coverage decisions should not be tied to the grade of the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendation.
Good morning, panel. My name is Veronica Mallett. I'm chair of the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Texas Tech El Paso. And my question is directed to Dr. Tobey, and it's regarding the state of Texas, who has refused steadfastly to expand Medicaid despite the fact that we have the highest percentage of uninsured individuals. And I would like for you to help me to predict the consequence that's going to have for teaching hospitals as the funds for uncompensated care disappear. We are a state with DSRIP funds, but those do not replace the funds for uncompensated care, and we provide a large percentage of our care is uncompensated care on the Texas-Mexico border.
Yes, I obviously, as you know, the Medicaid program is state-administered. The federal government, under the Supreme Court decision of 2012, the U.S. government was stymied in terms of really convincing the state to implement Medicaid expansion. And so in Texas, in those states which don't do the expansion, there are enormous cost to that particular state. And the cost, of course, is that the public hospitals, as you say, are going to be cut out of uncompensated care under the law of the Affordable Care Act. So the money is going to be reduced under Affordable Care Act. That's one hit. The second hit is that the state is not getting the people who would have been eligible for the care, so there won't be the admissions either, and the hospital, obviously, the public hospital is suffering a lot of competition locally for admissions on the other side. So you're not going to get the admissions, you're not going to get the money, and basically all the federal government can do is try to convince the state to eventually come into the system. And I think this is something that the Secretary of HHS has on her list. And this is a challenge for the future. The challenge is, how do you give some kind of an incentive to those states, which may be ideologically motivated, but also have budget directors who can educate them about the need to have this federal money? So I think this is the future challenge for CMS, is to get Texas to come into the system. And let's hope.
Well, I wonder if I might add a ground level supplement to Mr. Tobey's answer. I recently rotated off the board of Grady Hospital in Atlanta, and Georgia is one of those states that our governor refused to expand Medicaid. Grady's governance was privatized in 2008 because Grady was losing $50 million a year because of its inefficiencies being entrapped in the political system of the Fulton and DeKalb County commissions. With the privatization of the governance, we were able to streamline the operation of the hospital in terms of contracts, bid, et cetera, eliminate a lot of political patronage, et cetera. That deficit was reduced from around $50 million a year to around $10 million. Grady estimated that with the expansion of Medicaid, Grady's would receive an additional $75 million annually by that, because as Bill mentioned, the federal government reducing uncompensated care supplements because the law provides for expansion of coverage, so the theory is you'll have fewer uncompensated care patients coming for care, therefore the supplements were not needed. But if you don't get the supplements, of course, you really are in a bind. This is, in my view, a pure political decision because I say, as a Georgian, I want my tax dollars to come back to Georgia in for Medicaid expansion rather than going to those other states that are expanding it. This is really a decision that does not make economic sense for governors to refuse a program that the federal government gives 100% for the first 3 years and then tapers off down to 90% thereafter, in addition to the argument for providing care to people who are not getting it. I believe that we are going to see many of these states go over because it doesn't make economic sense for a governor of a state not to accept these dollars, whereas his citizens are supplementing this program in other states. That's not politically sustainable for the long term.
I would just add that the economic budget advisor to Governor Abbott did advise him that it's costing the state up to $100 million because it's costing employers by supplementing the care of the uninsured and by also costing the state more in terms of supplementing the other states. But the legislature only meets every 2 years, and they didn't even bring it up in discussion in this last session.
Thank you. Let me just comment for the audience. We are going to go until 12:30, so we want to have ample time to try and address all the questions. So, now the question.
Rick Baker, new faculty member here at Wayne State School of Medicine. And I wanted to direct this to the entire panel. The so-called glut in specialists and the need to decrease specialists in the country is what I would call a first world problem. We know that the data shows that in lower income and in medically underserved communities, which both of which are overwhelmingly African-American, overwhelming minority, the deficit in specialists is as extreme and in many cases even more extreme than the deficit in primary care. It's just a fact. So the advantages of primary care are lost if there's no cardiologist or no urologist or even no ophthalmologist to refer to. We know that. And also for these communities, we know that with respect to African-American specialists are four times more likely to serve in these communities despite the reimbursement advantages because that's what we do. Given that, Martin Luther King Hospital, when that went down, 40% of all the specialty slots in HBCUs went away. So right now, HBCUs do an outstanding job in terms of producing primary care physicians. However, with the exception of Howard, there are very few specialty slots in HBCUs. So the question is, how do we prevent ourselves from becoming a two-tier system? What are our strategies to ensure that we protect the specialty slots for African Americans?
Well, since I'm a specialist, I should probably take that first.
I'm probably more specialized than you.
That's right, she is.
Reproductive endocrinology and fertility.
She is, right?
glaucoma is pretty specialized. Well, okay, so let me, well, you know what, ladies first, go ahead.
No, oh, thank you. One of the things we clearly have to do at our HBCUs is that we recognize, even though we are very, very much committed to primary care, again, we want to give our students the opportunity to be educated and trained in whatever specialty area of medicine they choose to. And so we are really working hard to increase the number of our residency slots and increase the number and different types of residency programs. Clearly, some of the specialty areas in medicine where we should go first, infectious disease, cardiology, other areas that we definitely need to focus on because it aligns with the disparities that we see in the populations that we serve. In order to do that, we have to continue to advocate to increase the number of CMS-funded slots. But we're also expanding our opportunity with the VA. So when you look at what's happening at the Atlanta VA with Morehouse School of Medicine, we now have medicine, two medicine teams there. We have community health preventive medicine. We have psychiatry. And now we have finally gotten general surgery, cardiothoracic surgery, and vascular. All of those are with the intent that we will definitely end up increasing the number of residency slots that are available and then begin to extend that to other opportunities. So who we partner and collaborate with matters. When we look at the hospitals in the Atlanta area, we are definitely looking for partnerships that will be willing to partner with us in order to cover the costs of expanding to those residency programs for the first couple of years, and then we hopefully will become eligible for some CMS slots. It is definitely on our radar, but with the restrictions right now with CMS and supporting residency slots, we are held hostage to that.
So I find myself in committees a lot where I'm typically the only physician and a lot of other healthcare providers or health economists and things like that, and I'm a real promoter and defender of our primary care as the only physician in these committees. But I would tell you that among physicians, that it's not a primary care versus specialty care issue because there's shortage in all, particularly for minorities. You know, we have a shortage of ophthalmologists. We have a shortage of dermatologists. We have a shortage of reproductive endocrine, you know, we have a shortage for all these things, and what I'm really particularly bothered by is that, again, I talked about a little bit that to get into these specialties now is there's a bar that's set in terms of what your board scores are. I was talking to a new chair of ophthalmology of an Ivy League institution in a very diverse neighborhood, and I asked this person, you know, they're going to be more diverse in terms of selecting their residents, and his response was, well, you know, he just wants to select the best residents. Well, it's, you know, to me, it's a matter of how you define best, and too many times people are defining best by how high you score on the board exams, and that's the criteria they're using. So I'm very concerned, not only about the dearth of minority primary care physicians, but also of specialty physicians, and we shouldn't make it a specialty versus primary care issue.
Let me tell you what we're doing at the level of the Council of Deans. I sit on the executive committee for the Council of Deans, and we have a task force that is really looking at this GME issue. At our spring retreat, we had a symposium that I led along with Mark Neve that was 3 hours long, talking to 101 of the deans about the lack of diversity and inclusion at our medical schools and the challenges we had with the applicant pool and our selection process, and then we extended that to GME. And it was clear from the people that we identified on the panel who spoke that this GME issue is a really serious issue. And they are using cutoffs of step one and step two scores to even decide whether or not somebody is gonna even, of course, get an interview. Well, you know, if you don't get an interview, you're never gonna get in the selection discussion. And so we are committed at the Council of the Deans, at least some of us are, and continue to uncover what the challenges are and create discussions that lead to opportunity. And that is that we do have to have a holistic interview and approach, just like we've done in medical school, for the GME. And then we got to have the ACGME and the RRC as accrediting bodies to then put that as one of the standards for their continued accreditation. And then we have to take it a step further. We then have to tie funding to it from the CMS. And many of us are going to be advocating in that way, because until that happens, these are going to be good old person clubs, okay? And people are educating and training orthopedic surgeons and dermatologists and those type of things, those specialties, only with people who have certain board scores. And we know that those don't necessarily turn out to be the best providers.
Next question.
Yes. Thank you very much to the panelists and good morning. My question relates to something that Director Toby first brought up, but Dr. Riley also alluded to this, and several other people on the panel, so anyone who wants to comment, feel free. Medicaid expansion has come up a lot. And for context, I am the Indiana State Health Commissioner, which means I wear two hats. Number one, I sit on the governor's cabinet and know what's going on politically. And my governor is one of the most conservative governors in the United States, and we are also one of the few Republican states that accepted Medicaid expansion funds for to increase coverage within our state. Number two, I'm the head of the Indiana State Department of Health. So my concern comes from this idea that we just have to ram Medicaid expansion down everyone's throats and they just have to accept it. My concern is that in Indiana, via our Healthy Indiana plan, which we have a high deductible health plan with a health savings account, we've been able to increase reimbursement for providers. We've been able to demonstrate that we will be solvent after the subsidies from the federal government start to decrease. We've shown improved outcomes, and we're disproportionately helping minorities. We have 9.5% black in our state, and 19.4% of our enrollees since we've been approved for the expansion have been African American. However, we had to go through two different HHS secretaries. My governor had to run down the president on the tarmac, and this was all over the course of 18 months to get it approved. So I would love to hear you all comment on the concerns about trying to force people into what we know in many states is a broken system. I think it's going to hurt minority doctors who disproportionately take care of Medicaid patients if we don't pay attention to the low reimbursement that Medicaid gives out. And I think that we're going to subject largely minority populations to continued two-tier care if we say, you know what, we know Medicaid's not working in these states. It's not working optimally. It's certainly not working the way health coverage is for many other groups, but we're just going to force them to take it as a means of trying to increase coverage. And Director Toby, you brought up the DSH payments. If you do comment, another concern I have wearing my public health hat is the idea, both at the federal level, President Obama did not have the public health block grants included in his budget, and at the state level, and again, I'm hearing this from other governors, that, okay, now everyone has or should have coverage. This is the same argument they made for DSH. So we don't need to fund public health any longer, because now they can get their breast cancer screenings, their prostate screenings, everything that we were funding through public health, now they should get it through health coverage. While we know that African Americans, Latinos, minorities, and particularly undocumented people, aren't going to have that coverage necessarily, even though it's available. So, sorry, but I'd love to hear your comments.
We're going to try and limit the length of our questions so that we'll have a chance to respond. So, Bill, Mr. Toby? Yeah.
Well, you spoke about the fact that you're trying to have changes, and your governor had to chase the president down on the tarmac. And I think one way to avoid that is through what the Affordable Care Act provides. And that is, I'm thinking about Section 1332 of the Affordable Care Act, which allows the government to make major changes in Medicaid, major changes. and eligibility, and also on the benefit package and how you deliver the services. So I would look to Section 1332 because CMS would welcome that kind of change and the governor would get approval. And you can also increase the payments as well as an experiment, or a demonstration, I should say. On the Medicaid expansion, I just think that is terribly important for our people, okay? It's more important than ACOs and all these other very fancy kinds of things, medical homes. I see medical homes and ACOs as a middle-class vision of healthcare. It has nothing to do with the fundamental problems facing Black Americans and Hispanics, nothing to do. I talked about Brooklyn, 3 o'clock in the morning, you're sick, you need to help. You gotta look for a hospital. There is no clinic to keep you, primary care center to keep you healthy. There are no health services in Brooklyn for 2.5 million people with obesity, hypertension, diabetes. There is no healthcare delivery system. I mean, there is no system there capacity to help you. So I think, you know, expansion is very good because it gets you, absolutely, it gets you covered. And as you know, if you get covered, treatment follows. You don't have coverage, there's no treatment. So I see that as good, and I also think you have to do both. You can't just depend on, you have to do all those other things in the system, as you said, and looking at the payment, the low payments, we have to find a way to fix that. I think Obamacare leads, I use Obamacare, the president uses it when it's positive also, but I use Obamacare to say that I think in the future, that kind of problem in terms of payment reform is underway under the Affordable Care Act. It gives me much more hope, I think. But I think Section 1332 is the way to go in the future if you haven't taken advantage of that.
Well, we got the expansion. I think the governors in other states have a legitimate argument about the Medicaid system being broken, and we're being tone deaf to that when we're not acknowledging that it's broken. And I think there will be negative outcomes if we just force everyone onto Medicaid without pointing out those options.
Commissioner, your point's well taken. The policy discussion is broader in terms of Medicaid reform. But, you know, it's not so much a matter of us, as the American College of Physicians say, just cram Medicaid down governor's throats. No, we've never advocated that. We've advocated what your governor did. Come up with an Indiana-specific plan that meets the federal test of the specific level of benefits. The Affordable Care Act had a two-year provision of a 10% bonus payment for primary care. Unfortunately, that sunsetted. So I'm up on Capitol Hill trying to get the Congress to restore that. So we know that there's some payment fixes that have to happen. We've never been oblivious to that. But the politics of this, particularly in the South, is, I live in Tennessee. Our governor, a moderate Republican, has put forth three times a Medicaid proposal, a Tennessee plan, modeled after the Indiana plan, modeled after the Arkansas plan, the Pennsylvania plan, in fact. But the politics in these state houses precludes even thoughtful discussion or debate around coming up with a plan as your governor did. With CMS.
Thank you very much.
Question here.
Yes, thank you all. This has been a really wonderful panel. I'm Lisa Merritt. I now live in Sarasota, Florida, another great state for non-responsive to reality. And I'm happy to say that I am a proud graduate of Howard University Medical School, Faculty Development Program at Morehouse, and I'm currently Executive Director of the Multicultural Health Institute. And I'm really happy you answered some of my concerns about the residency issue, so I'll stay off of that. So talking about the pipeline issue, it's again, it's like a bigger picture of the whole social determinants of health with regards to health delivery. And I think we do a lot of this and that and this and that. And what I'd like to hear and suggest more of is how do we collaborate Dr. Kamara Jones, I was happy to hear her. She came down. I was on the steering committee in Florida to develop the Health Equities Research Institute, which is a group headed through the public health programs in Florida, but really trying to look at a cohesive strategy, a strategic plan on our health delivery system, and how do we tie in training programs, pipeline issues, access issues, prevention strategies, et cetera. But more importantly, what I've been committed to, not only in my own work with mentoring and trying to get young people along, is how do we get that message? We do so well at speaking to ourselves. How do we make sure to get this message in an understandable and tangible way and build the leadership amongst those that we have to find a way to find partnership with, because there'll never be enough of us. And so I teach a course right now, and I'm interested to know how can smaller organizations partner and work together so that we can get everyone on board in every state to have a HERI, to have a mentoring program, and to develop pipeline issues. In Florida in 2011, we only had 34 African-American medical school graduates in the entire state of Florida. We're right now working with an above grade level reading program, which looks at the early childhood phase from 0 to 3, and the fact that we know if those children aren't getting the right interventions through the Annie Casey Foundation. And Florida is 37th in the country when it comes to child health and wellness issues. So all of these things tie together, and we as physicians kind of know them, but we need to make it in a way that's objective for other people to get why it's worth the investment on making sure that children are getting the nutrition, et cetera, et cetera. We can build that pipeline together to increase the numbers and to increase the eligible applicants. You know, I have a few, so how do I make sure? What networks can I work with to make sure those kids get the right connections and have a chance to be seen, because they're dealing from school systems that are inferior, you know, and they may not do as well on the tests.
I think we get the
okay. Please. Thank you, Dr.
Yes.
Sullivan.
So,
who we collaborate and partner with matters. And so a couple of things. Tomorrow at the press conference, when we talk about the lack of black males in medical school, you will hear from the four presidents of the HBCUs, and you will hear some of the things that we're going to do collaboratively. But also at the Council of Deans level, we are attempting to identify 2 to 3 programs that are scalable, and then to get a commitment from many of our other academic health centers to implement those programs. Now, in order to support that, we're going to have to collaborate with multiple other organizations like the Kaiser Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, those foundations that say, the American Medical Association, that they are interested in the creation and advancement of health equity.
Right.
And we will have the appropriate metrics and outcomes and monitoring that is required. And some of those programs we're looking at that will reach down into starting in the third grade and following thereof. Some right. of them will be more middle school, high school, and college related. But the HBCUs, we don't have the capacity alone to do this.
Right.
And so the Wayne States and the other institutions that are committed to this, we must partner and collaborate. We understand that if you go to every medical school, they will tell you they have a pipeline program. And they can identify 5, 10, 20, sometimes up to 100 kids that they touch at that moment. But it's the continuity of that touch.
Exactly.
That matters. I always tell people, when people talk about thugs, you remember a thug is just a person who hasn't had a hug. That's all a thug
is.
Oh,
that's great.
And if we would reach out and extend touch to these kids in a continuous fashion, then they can become those kids that we aspire for them to be.
Precisely. Thank you.
Question.
My name is Dr. Schleter. I'm the Chief Medical Officer for the Eau Claire Cooperative Health Center. It's a community health center, a large community health center in Columbia, South Carolina. And I guess I appreciate Dr. Sullivan for putting this together. This, I was not expecting what we've had yesterday and today and coming. And as it was said, this was really a monumental event to be a part of, and sometimes you don't realize how important something is until afterwards and you reflect back. So I really appreciate putting it together. The other comment that I have is the isms, the racism, and especially that put on African Americans. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make economic sense. It doesn't make sense for the benefit of the country, but it exists. And I think as we move forward, we have to understand that as we talk about Affordable Care Act in South Carolina, it doesn't make sense. Our state in South Carolina is one of the most poorest states. And whether it's African American or white, there are so many individuals who could benefit, but our leadership has not made that decision, and it doesn't make sense. And that is what we have before us. We can put charts and graphs and put a lot of persuasive reasoning, but we're dealing with a community that doesn't make sense. And it's not until you have something like happened in Charleston where the flag comes down. If that hadn't happened, it would have gone on having the flag on our state house grounds for years until something happens. And so I guess I just want to encourage you guys to continue the fight that you're doing, because it is very expansive from all the things that we're talking about. Continue the fight, but also I get a sense we have some momentum going in terms of what's going on in the country and the groundswell, in terms of the things that are going on with the killings and things, to come together and take advantage of this and to really come out with some serious policy statements. And hopefully we can build a groundswell of momentum that we can really get some change while the time that we have. Because if we don't take advantage of it, we might find that we've is passed by, and now we got this groundswell of, hey, there are other things that are important on the agenda. So please continue working together, but coming together with those policies that can make a difference.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Question.
Michael Lawrence, Geriatrics, Private Practice, Eastern North Carolina. Thanks for a wonderful presentation from all the panel. My question is, you will remember several years ago, we were told by Washington that AIG was too big to fail. So God forbid that in 2016, Jeb Bush or Donald Trump inherits the White House. Do you think that the Affordable Care Act is already so entrenched, so big, so great, that take into account the states in the South where it is so unpopular, that it will be deemed too big to repeal, that by the touch of someone's pen, the Affordable Care Act does not disappear when a new president inherits the White House in 2016-2017?
I'll jump out there. I think it's going to be incredibly difficult. God forbid if one of those at least gets elected president, the other's more reasonable. I think you've heard Jeb Bush say that he would take a look at things. And I think he's moderating his language, right? Because Jeb Bush knows it's going to be terribly difficult to unravel health insurance markets serving 25 million people. It'd be terribly disruptive to the economy. And that's why King versus Burwell, in my estimation, in our view at the American College of Physicians, that was the final test. They're going to try reconciliation, as Bill Tobey said, but that's going to fail. And so the next thing after that is the election. So again, our prognostication is we think it is durable enough to withstand even a president who comes in thinking that he or she can, win it down, because it's just going to be so mature by that point. The insurance markets, the number of insurers, the providers, the payment mechanisms, the quality, there'll be more ACOs, et cetera. It's going to be baked into the DNA of this country, by 2016, 2017.
Too big to repeal.
Thank you.
Hello, wonderful consultation and dialogue. I'm Morris Brown, Section Chair of Family Medicine.
And definitely I agree with all that's been said. The pipeline definitely is a trickle now. But I'm concerned about what I haven't heard you guys say. I don't think anybody else cares about those numbers but us. And it looks to me that the decision makers, both the payers and maybe even the government, I don't think the colleges are involved in it, but I do believe that the decisions have been made to replace primary care with the extenders, both nurse practitioners and physician assistants. And the reason I say that is, I serve on boards for some of the pharma companies, and I also have had some experience with some insurance companies at a board level. And what you see is that physicians, especially primary care physicians, are lumped together with providers. And within that provider lump are these extenders. So the decision has been made to replace these docs with extenders. And I think the decision is, do you need 4 years of college and 3 years of family medicine, board certified, or even internal medicine to take care of primary care people? And I strongly think the decision was made that that's not necessary now, that you can take a nurse and give her 2 years of training and replace the Morris Browns of the world.
Well, let me say this. There's always, from the beginning, there's always been concern about physicians, assistants, and nurse practitioners, but I don't believe that there's really any organized effort to replace primary care physicians, but really to expand the reach of primary care. The problem is that too many communities, as you've heard, don't get primary care. But so far as physicians, assistants, and nurse practitioners, you find them working along with orthopedists. I had a hip replacement 9 years ago. When I go back for a checkup, I don't see the orthopedist, I see the physician's assistant, because this orthopedist is so overwhelmed with the number of people he is trying to see. So I think what we recognize is the system of health professions education really has a lot of problems, one of them being the high amount of debt that students graduate with, and that's interfering with us getting more people into primary care. I think the average business person is looking for ways to get care for his or her employees, but really at minimal cost. And I do think that is going to require reconfiguring how care is provided. And that's one of the reasons that you have these minute clinics that are so successful. People are having difficulty getting care. These are available for reasonable costs with minimal waiting. So I think we have to reconfigure the system to see that we get care. But I've not sensed any effort or organized effort or thought of really replacing primary care physicians and simply having specialists. I would seriously doubt that.
Yeah, I agree. Our position at the American College of Physicians is it's nuanced. There's no way we can disenfranchise nurse practitioners, PAs, from participation in patient care. That would be a foolhardy position for us to take, or any medical organization. What we do say, though, is that that has to be appropriate to the circumstance. There's a nurse practitioner cannot replace you. And I know your organization. I've been walking the hill with Bob Wergen as well, the president of the American Academy of Family Physicians. Your organization has taken a very strong, similar position to ours, that physicians have to be a part of any setting, that there has to be appropriate use of physician extenders, PAs, nurse practitioners, et cetera, but that there should be limits to the extent to which they are allowed to practice independently, if at all.
Thank you. Question.
Hi. Good afternoon. Thank you guys for your presence here today and your dynamic presentations. I really appreciated it. My name is Adrienne Jordan, and I am a medical school graduate, although I have not been permitted to enjoy that title. And I'm not saying enjoying the title of having an MD, but the duties that accompany taking care of patients as a physician. We as healthcare professionals do all we can to assist and serve patients. When they are ill, we run tests, we order labs, and we continue to pursue treatment until we discover a solution to their condition. We do not by any means give up on our patients or their care. However, we give up on our medical school students and medical school graduates when they have had academic challenges while completing their undergraduate medical education. Sometimes administration will find excuses to exclude us instead of including us, when in fact they should not give up on us either. Although we are not former inmates, we are having similar experiences in gaining employment. So my question is there a way to reserve residency spots for American graduates in order to level the playing field? Because many times, numerous residency programs are not comprised of many residency programs are comprised of non-American graduates. Secondly, can we end test discrimination? And what I mean by that is if a student does not pass his boards on their initial attempt, he should still be permitted to pursue his dream of becoming a clinician and practicing medicine. And instead of opening more medical schools, we can employ the physicians that we have that are not working, like myself, to bridge the shortage gap. When doctors William Osler and Halstead founded residency training programs, I don't think they meant for the system to exclude medical school graduates. Thank you.
So first of all, I think that as a dean of a medical school and a president, this is a significant area that we are attempting to address. So first of all, we are concerned about how test scores are used as gatekeepers. And we at Morehouse School of Medicine and many other schools do not use that. We look at academically diverse students because we see the potential, and that is only one piece of data. However, to extend that understanding to all schools is the education in progress. And Dr. Wilson talked about the holistic review and how, as he sits at an urban serving majority institutions, how they will begin to look at things again differently. We also must extend that to the GME. And you are correct. I do believe that we make a contract with students who attend medical school in the United States, LCME accredited schools, that we are making essentially a contract with them that they will get a residency training spot. So many of us are challenged with the number of foreign medical graduates who are coming in and taking those slots from our students. Now, unfortunately, we cannot control all of the aspects that contribute to that, but we are trying to look at legal ways in which we can address this issue. And I can tell you, one of the things that people said to me, some people said to me outside was, you know, we don't want there to be discrimination against African-born physicians, et cetera. That is not the intent. The intent is not be instead of, but in addition to. And so we do have a commitment to African-American-born students that they should, or any student born in the United States, should have access to those residency training programs. However, there is law based on employment that prevents us from necessarily just holding out the slots. But people are looking at alternative ways. Roy, you may want to comment.
Yeah, so I in my presentation, I mentioned the issue with the test scores and how insidious that was. And it's not just getting into medical school, but how that translates into getting residencies and so forth. And that's kind of what I was thinking of because, you know, as far as I know right now, you still have six chances to pass the boards. Is that right? You know, so to me, it should be a competency-based issue. If you end up being able to pass the boards and you have the minimal knowledge that is thought to be required to be a physician, then regardless of, you know, when you pass the board, you should be able to get a residency program and practice. I mean, that's the practical side of it. The reality of it is that, you know, people are using these scores as a litmus test. And if you don't pass on the first time, or certainly if you don't pass by the second time, and you have other students from, foreign-born students, who are getting 90s and 98s on their scores, they're taking these spots. So it is a big, big issue. I'm on the board of the AAMC, and I actually asked that it be put on the agenda for the next meeting to discuss all these issues, because I think it's well beyond just getting into medical school, but it permeates the entire system.
One thing I'd like to add to this discussion is this. One of the dimensions that doesn't get much attention is the fact that we in the United States have benefited from other countries to their detriment. And by that I mean this. I was confronted by the Minister of Health in Malawi when I was secretary, telling me that, first of all, there were 92 Malawian physicians in the country. There were more of them in England than in Malawi. And he said that the Western countries drain us of our manpower. Why can't you train your own manpower in your own country and not really take our brightest? Because one of the issues that the foreign medical graduate issue raises is, indeed, what are we as a nation doing that is to the detriment of other nations that we want to see prosper? Now, that is a more complicated question because some of the problems in those countries is that the environment for physicians is not as optimal as it should be. But one of the things that is happening is this is something that isn't in a vacuum. We are disadvantaging other countries. One of the things that was pointed out in a meeting I attended in Uganda 2 years ago was the fact that Africa as a continent has 25% of the world's illness and injury, but only 3% of the health professionals. So the foreign medical graduate poses a problem here domestically, but internationally, we are also disadvantaging those countries we'd like to see develop themselves so they become stronger, healthier countries, and so that's another issue. I think we have time for one more question before Dr. Santos comes up.
Yes. Okay. My name is Lannis Hall. I'm a radiation oncologist at Siteman Cancer Center, Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis. And I want to thank the panel for an excellent morning session. My question is a little bit of a follow-up to the PSA screening and the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendation. That recommendation was actually grade D, which meant there are more harms than benefit to screening with PSA, and that was particularly because of over-treatment concerns and unnecessary biopsies. The real problem with this grade D recommendation was it was based on two studies of which there were no African-American men, less than 5%, so there was no ability to do a subpopulation analysis. When you have a group of people in the United States, African-American men, with a 2.4 times greater mortality, but yet they were not included in the study, it is unconscionable that you can then do a blanket recommendation for screening across the board. What is so concerning now is, as you know, they just came out with lung cancer screening recommendations based on risk, but then would not do PSA screening based on risk. How do we let our membership know, NMA and ACP, that these two studies did not include people who had the greatest tumor burden, the greatest incidence, 2.4 times greater mortality, but yet the recommendation is not to screen and there's no other way to detect prostate cancer at an early stage? And then how do we make sure in the future that when we have policy recommendations that are blanketed that impact insurance reimbursement, that we make certain that all populations are represented in these studies?
Thank you, Doc. That's the power of medical organizations. The NMA has to weigh in. State it just as you did. You just gave the best explication of the problem with the development of that grade of recommendation that I've ever heard. Yeah. You got to get it out there. And that's the role of professional organizations to be that voice. Remember, the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force is an agency of the government. It falls under the, as I recall, the Federal Advisory Act. It's appointed either by the secretary or the assistant secretary. Right, Lou?
the right. U.S. Preventive Services. So that's where the pressure needs to be placed. Say, look, the composition of the Preventive Service Task Force is not as diverse as it needs to be, not only of race and ethnicity, but of diversity of perspective on major issues facing vulnerable populations.
I think that that takes our time, and as Dr. Saunders comes forward, let me thank the panelists for their presentations and their discussion. I think this has been truly outstanding. Dr. Saunders.
All right, thank you very much. In the interest of time, I want to thank you, the audience. I think this has been a very provocative session, a very important session, where we've talked about creating a future for health equity. We've covered the role of the university, we've covered the role of the workforce, we've covered the role of the association, and we've looked at the framework that is going to help guide us forward in terms of the Affordable Care Act. I've got a few people I want to thank. I want to thank Dr. William Jackson. I want to thank each of the panelists. Dr. Riley, Dr. Montgomery Rice, Dr. Wilson, and Mr. Toby. And I have a special thanks for Dr. Sullivan. Dr. Sullivan, your team that put this together asked me to make a special award here, and I'm going to do this. This is to recognize Dr. Sullivan for his participation and contribution to this year's NMA conference. For his exemplary life of excellence and service, working on health disparities, working as a student, as a researcher, as an educator, as a historian, as an autobiographer, and as Secretary of Health and Human Services. This is for his continuing dedication as Chairman of the Sullivan Alliance, President of the National Museum of Health, and as a participant and speaker in so many programs that I'm not even going to try to name them. So therefore, I want to present this citation as a lifetime achievement in the science and art of medicine to you, Dr. Sullivan. Good. Thank you all very much, and thank you, Dr. Sullivan, because I think you stepped in and made our plenary sessions this year appropriate, relevant, and important. Thank you very much.